Arto? Arto? Where are you? Arto? Arto? Arto, you're on fire! R2-D2, you found a cigarette. Well, I don't think smoking is grown up at all. Because it's very dangerous. Smoking does dreadful things to your lungs and is very bad for your heart. Well, I know I don't have one, but humans do, and I think we should set a good example. Well done, R2. Oh, hello. You know smoking is bad for your health, and it isn't grown up at all. So please, don't smoke. R2, do you really think I don't have a heart?
I'm sorry that he was scheduled to be here, but unfortunately at the last minute something came up and he was unable to attend. But I know we'll have a great session today. So I'm just going to rip right into my presentation, just talk a little bit about some of our successes. To remind everyone that Mayor Jackson believes that the city of Cleveland should be a place to live, work, and play. This is critically important. We've put a lot of money into parks. We've put a lot of money into economic development. And you know, we think it's important that housing and place are more and more important when we look at our neighborhoods. And so we've tried to make some strategic investments in those areas, despite the fact that we've been in a recession and it's been very difficult to have the funds to be able to do that. So that's something that's really important. I just wanted to, if people have not seen this diagram, our presentations will be up on the website today. But I think this is a pretty cool diagram about place. And it talks about all the things that create place in your neighborhood. And so it's something that you can take a look at. If you just Google placemaking, economic development as a place, anything you Google, it's going to pop up all kinds of things. Chicago's doing an incredible project right now where they've got all their residents suggesting what projects they could do to develop place, and they'll fund the top six. So that's a pretty cool idea. It's just as I was Googling it, I'm like, oh, look at this. So some great ideas out there, check it out. But it's really about finding out what your residents really believe that your neighborhood should be and, or could be. And if, I know we have a few planners in the room, so that's about as close to planning as I get, so as I'm more into doing. So when you get done with this part, come see me. But it is an important part. So here, an important thing is you've got to take inventory. What do you have? What's missing? What are your residents going to support? And I think there's a couple more bullets there. Maybe not. Okay. So it's really important that we do this. What I need people to do is, if you're going to try to sell your neighborhood to retail, you have to know your residents will come for that. Or if not your residents, guests, visitors, people come to work in that neighborhood, but you really got to find out what they're going to do. Because if you sell a retail establishment, you know, if I make, say I make like a snakeskin bags, and I've decided to come into a particular neighborhood, but it's a neighborhood where people are all animal rights activists, and they decide that there's no way in heck they're going to buy that, well, it's probably not going to be very successful. So if you don't know who your residents are and what they're really interested in, you know, you could go out and work really hard to bring somebody in and they'll fail. So if you don't know what your residents want, then you're in trouble. Who can you partner with? We're going to be talking about some successes, and all of these successes have partnered with a lot of different people.
So partnerships are really key. Are there low-cost actions you can take to move an area forward? And I'll tell you that, you know, we, Catherine and I did a drive yesterday. We did, I think, 12 neighborhoods. I couldn't do all 46 in 4 hours, but we did 12. And, you know, in some of the neighborhoods, the first thing you notice is you need to be out there sweeping. And, you know, I was talking to Tim Tramble today. He has, like, an incredibly great story of how they hired someone for 2 hours a day at $10 an hour and then worked their way up. And this gentleman has created an entire business out of this because then another retail area said, yeah, oh, we could hire him too. And then finally, Peter Rubin at Coral hired him for Shaker Square. So the guy's now making like 50 grand a year. And he started off by doing 2 hours a day with Tim. And I think that's a fabulous story. Hopefully you weren't going to tell that later and I just stole your whole speech. But it was moving for me because it's a story of what a little bit you can do to really create something. And that's the one thing in Tim's neighborhood. When we drove by that neighborhood, everything looked pristine. And I said, because that's how we got in the conversation, I said, boy, drove down by your neighborhood and, you know, everything was neat and clean and, you know, there wasn't a piece of paper out of place. And so many neighborhoods we drove through, you know, really looked like a place that, you know, a person probably wouldn't want to shop there. So that's something, when I say you have homework, you need to go through and look at these neighborhoods through a different lens. Not like I'm driving to work and I drive by my neighborhood, but I don't look at it. You need to look at it and see what your residents are seeing, see what your visitors might see, commuters who drive down that road, and you need to say to yourself, maybe there are some things I could do, small things that don't cost a lot. Get a neighborhood cleanup, you know, once a month, the Boy Scouts come, I don't know. But figure it out because cleanliness is one of the biggest things and you're gonna need to think about what you can do to get that done. So there's a lot of projects that have done pretty well in Cleveland, some not so much, but we're gonna talk about a couple. I'm gonna talk about a few, then Kevin's gonna talk about a few. And every one of these have taken hard work and partnerships. If you don't have partnerships, if you don't figure out who can help you, if you don't even reach out. I had a CDC recently and I was trying to do something around painting and they're telling me how much it's gonna cost. I said, have you talked to Sherwin Williams or Home Depot or anybody to see if they'll donate? This is a new thing. We were just talking about something else, but different CDC. And I said, go and find out what they'll do for you because, you know, the city can't pay for everything. I wish it could. If I could pay for everything, I'd paint the whole town. But we can't pay for everything. So you've got to go out and try to figure out every resource that's out there. And business partners are important too because there are businesses who really want their neighborhood to look great. If they're in your neighborhood, then you've got to say to yourself, maybe I can go to them and say, hey, we're trying to paint on our retail corridor here. We're trying to do this. You know, is it possible you could make a donation for paint? Or maybe you can get paint at a huge discount because you're a big company. And, you know, so that's the type of thing that that you got to think about before you come to me, please, okay? Some of the places that we'll talk about too, they went through an entire retail development and then they kind of went up and then they went down. And now they're going back up again because you have to reinvent yourself, okay? America has a love of new, we know that. It's one of our reasons we have a housing crisis is because the houses that maybe our parents and grandparents lived in, or for some of you great-grandparents, they feel old sometimes, those houses are probably not the houses that you and I might say, oh, that's a perfect house for me. Because a lot of those houses might not have that big open floor plan. America has a love of new. I think we have a lot of historic properties that we can repurpose that can be beautiful again. And, you know, but it sometimes takes more vision than the average person has. If it's gonna be hard work, sometimes people say, well, we have busy lives, and if I have to make that look great again, I'm not sure. So you gotta help them along with that. And there's a few people in this audience who do a fantastic job of helping people with vision. Go ahead, Victoria. So Uptown, this is Case Western's college town. So we had a college with no cool place to hang out. Most colleges have a college town. They have like a little
kind of like a little downtown, a place where there's retail. I went to Case, and I can tell you we had to go up to Coventry to hang out. That was a lot of years ago. Then they got a little strip mall with like a McDonald's, okay? And that was supposed to be like the place. And of course, that didn't really work because most students in the Ivy really not looking for McDonald's. So that was a big thing. So Case had to reinvent itself. Case recognized they had issues. So they got brought in a developer, but the developer alone couldn't make that work. And the interesting partnership was that Case Western actually guaranteed the lease for the Barnes & Noble. And that was the only way to get that deal done in the market. So that was the unique partnership that they were able to put together. So they thought when they first did the project that all they were going to have to do is say, developers come, we got all these students, it's going to be great. And then they found out in the market, which was 2008, tough time, that they had to step up and do a little extra. But it certainly has changed Case Western's campus. As a matter of fact, they have the highest enrollment they've ever had, but they have not in any way reduced the test score levels that they accept. So they had more people of very high caliber applying, and they accepted more people. So they're at one of their highest enrollments right now, and they credit this development as being one of the reasons why. Because when parents come with their kids and they visit the campus, they now see, wow, this is a great area. It's exciting. It has all these amenities close by. It's walkable. So I think that was a great example. Garrett Square, of course, I can't talk enough about Garrett Square. Oh, on top of it being a vacant big box, it was also a brownfield. This is the former location of the Cleveland Transit Authority bus depot. So we had to do extra work there, and that was one of the things that the ladies also pointed out to me, is that they didn't want any problems environmentally. And one lady actually did that to me. She's like, I don't want any problems. I said, ma'am, I promise you, we will not do that to you. We will get it cleaned up, and we'll make sure the state says, yeah, you're cleaned up. So we went through that process. It took a little extra time. And again, having a developer who understands that and can work with you, critically important. So to me, this is great. And so Save-A-Lot and Foreman Mills, we've got Advanced Auto now, is one of the outlots. And I know that Mr. Jablonski is working on yet another adjacent piece. So we're excited about that. And as I said, the big thing here is that the folks who lived in that neighborhood, they wanted it. We knew what they wanted because they made it very clear. So go ahead, Mr. Here's Ariel International Center. We're here. Sometimes the sheer will of just one person or a couple of persons can change an area. And if anyone had ever been in this building years ago, it was left electric. They moved out to the suburbs. It was vacant. You could actually go roller skating in this building. They would have some type of like Saturday night type of gig up here where you could go roller skating. I've never been to that because I can't roller skate. But I'd heard about it. But that was it. That was all that happened here. And so Radhika came. She had this incredible vision. She saw this, this great parking here, this incredible view, which by the way, these were all bricked up windows. So she couldn't see the view from inside the building, but she went up on the roof. And she said, oh my goodness, this is incredible. This is the perfect place for me. And she worked as her own general contractor. She figured it out. People turned her down. She fought and fought. She dealt with the building department. She dealt with getting a liquor license. See, Radhika's vision is it's an international center. So there's an international incubator. She's got about three or four international companies that are here, located in one of the lower floors. She wants her vision for the first floor is for all kind of like an international marketplace. So where you could buy things, but also food, like a food court of international companies. So you come from downtown or one of these companies around here, and you pull in and you come in and, one day you might want Ethiopian, the next day you might want Indian, the next day you might want Mexican. It's all here and on the first floor. So that's her vision for this place. I know she's going to get there because every step of the way I've seen what she's been able to do. And sometimes there's a person who has that kind of vision. Ohio City, Sam McNulty, and Mark Premier, those two guys have been incredible. They did the Market Garden Brewery. They did Nano Brew. And what I think is particularly interesting about these guys is
When Hansa Brewery was starting, they came in, they gave us their pro forma, they wanted us to fund them. And, you know, we said, well, it's, you know, we need more market information and some other stuff. And so Sam McNulty went over there and helped the guy, his future competitor, because Sam McNulty has the vision to understand that having more in that neighborhood is better, and that it'll help his business. It's not necessarily going to be his competitor. It's a little bit different from what he offers, but he realized that the more we grow this neighborhood, the more people will come, and the more we can capture them here for a longer period of time. So the guy's very smart, and you know, you've got to find that guy in your neighborhood, or woman, like Rajika. So, people with vision. Steelyard Commons. I have to bring up Steelyard Commons because many people said, oh my God, Steelyard Commons is going to destroy neighborhood retail. And what I want to say to you is, in Cleveland, neighborhood retail existed before Steelyard Commons, but the problem is that $1.3 billion in retail spending was leaving our area. I live in the city, I love living in the city, but I had to drive, I live on the west side, so I drive to Parmatown, I have to drive to someplace over there, west, what is that, Great Northern. It's been a long time since I've been there. So, yeah, I had to drive a far distance, and people on the east side had to drive, they went to Beechwood, they went to Euclid, wherever. So, we were losing all this money. So when we added Steelyard Commons, it provided an amenity for our residents that's critical for people making decisions to move to Cleveland. Okay, if I go to South Hills Hardware when I want something small, but there are certain things I can't get at South Hills Hardware. They don't carry it. It's only so big. So I need that big Home Depot store to find some major project my husband has decided he's doing, and we've got to find what we need. So that's an important part of Cleveland's retail mix. We need to have it. So as much as people say to me, oh, it's doing this, it's doing that, it's still, you know, Tremont, Ohio City, I see them booming. So I really believe that Steelyards is a very big plus for us. And so if anyone wants to debate that with me, we're gonna have lunch today. Just come find me and we can talk about it. I'll give you all my points, you give me all yours, we'll duke it out, and if it's a tie, we can arm wrestle. So, but the one thing I wanted to point out, if you go to Steelyard Commons website, on their website, they have their pitch sheet. They've got all their facts and figures. And this is something, part of your homework, is for each of your neighborhoods, there's something important and good about your neighborhood. You've got residents, you've got people who drive by, you've got people who go to work in your neighborhoods. So the question is, how do you gather that data in a way that you can put it out there so that if you don't know someone's looking at your neighborhood, they can find it and they can say, hey, maybe this is worth, who do I call? And maybe it's worth giving a call, okay? So you've gotta have that type of information out there. And I looked at a few CDC websites, I didn't see much in that regard. So that's your homework, you gotta figure that out. How many people live in your neighborhood? What's their average income? It's all available information. Your neighborhood planner can help you. So planners, please tell Bob that I have volunteered them. So, but this is all information that's available and you need to have it on your website. And that's one of the reasons that Edie is getting a brand new website. Thank you, Jenna. And because, you know, we realize that people are looking at Cleveland even when they're not telling us they are, and they do that through our website. And if our website looks, well, frankly, like it does now, then we're probably not getting a lot of people interested in Cleveland. So I'll be very excited when we get our new website done, and people can go in there, search on properties, they can find out a lot of information about Cleveland, including demographic information, which we don't have on there right now. So that's an important part. I need everyone, that's your homework, okay? And you can check out Steelyards, because that's a good example. Go ahead, Victoria. Ohio City, obviously, Market Garden Brewery is good. Go ahead, Victoria. And just some of the other things. One of the things that I know Catherine will mention a little bit about is activating your neighborhood. And Ohio City does a great job. Obviously, they got a new park across the street, but it doesn't have to be a new park. It just has to be a space. And they do Saturdays there. They've got like people come with carts, and they can set up their carts and they sell stuff. And, well, they know they got thousands of people going to the West Side Market, which is nice, but you can create that buzz. St. Clair Superior is doing that now with Cleveland Flea. Has anyone gone to the Flea? Okay, so Flea is cool. And if you haven't gone, check it out, because that's something you might want to do similar in your neighborhood. But they're getting a lot of people. How many people have shown up? Have you counted them?
It started with about 1,000, and then it grew to about 3,000 every 3 weeks.
Yeah. So wouldn't it be great if you had 3,000 people every 3 weeks coming into your neighborhood? Because people, when they come into your neighborhood, they find other stuff. And they say, wow, I didn't know this was here. Or, wow, isn't that building cool? Or, wow, this is a pretty hip, trendy place. We like it. Maybe there's some storefronts available. You don't know who's going to be in that audience that's coming down there. So think about it. How can you activate it? Go ahead. I think that was it. Oh, here's some things about Cleveland. I love to, one of the things we found out in our branding exercise is that our own worst enemy is the people who live and work in the city of Cleveland. So I will just tell you that there's a lot of great things about Cleveland, and anytime you are out at a cocktail party, a barbecue, a family event, and people start trashing our town, that's your other homework, you gotta say something positive about Cleveland. Stop them from saying it. Say, excuse me, I don't agree. Challenge them, okay? And tell them something great. Here's some good things. This will be up on our website. You can pull it down. We're fourth in the nation for finding a job, fourth in the world for bar hopping, Ohio City. Okay, that was USA Today. Oh, no, excuse me, not in the nation. In the world, okay? That was a good one. USA Today said that. I was like, hey, I love that. Yahoo Travel said we were fourth most visionary city, okay, in the world, okay, for urban farming movement. So there's a lot of superlatives that is Cleveland. The unfortunate thing is that so many of our own residents go out and say, oh, Cleveland, which, you know, being from Boston and moving here and staying here, I've never seen it. And my poor husband, you can imagine if you're going out with me somewhere and I overhear people talking trash about Cleveland, my poor husband has to wait while I have a small debate in an elevator or, you know, at a cocktail party or, you know, even worse with one of his family members. So, but, you know, it does not bother me, because my viewpoint is if you don't stand up and say something, then you are part of the problem. So be part of the solution. Find some good things to say about your town. And when somebody's saying something bad, and including about our sports teams, we are blessed to have major league teams here in Cleveland. And that's the response I can make. When they say, oh, well, we always lose. I said, we're lucky to have major league teams. Like, would you like to be Omaha, Nebraska? Okay, so come out, support your teams, and quit complaining, because not everyone can win. And for years, I grew up in Boston for years, you know, I hate to tell you, we called the Patriots the Pastriots, because they were terrible. And the Red Sox didn't win, we had the curse, remember? So, you know, every team goes through losing periods. We're not a huge market, but we have baseball here. And we have football here, and we have basketball here, and we have minor league hockey. So sports are there. You can take your kids to a game, and that's what it should be all about. It's not about winning every single time. So anyways, those are my little comments. So it's now my job to invite Kevin Schwanzer up. And Kevin is our executive for small business. And he's going to talk a little bit about what we're doing in retail.
So one of the things I briefly want to talk about, for many of you I know this Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program, which has done probably close to 100 projects in the neighborhoods, every ward, since this was put in place in 2007. This has really been a great tool to partner up with Community Development Storefront Renovation to provide gap financing for small neighborhood retail projects, including restaurants, which actually, when we created this program in 2007, so this is our seventh year, I was surprised at how many restaurants have really utilized this program and gotten funded in the neighborhood. So it's been a great tool and success, and you're going to see some of the restaurants that have received funding under this program here. I'm going to outline. So many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with this shopping district, which has been a big suburban shopping district for years that was built. And now this is what it looks like today. How many of you have been to this neighborhood retail shopping district within the last 30 days? Good, no hands, that's what I wanted to see. Nobody has been there. So why is this looking like this today? There's a lot of reasons why. We're not going to get into that. But what do we want in our neighborhoods here on the five neighborhoods I'm going to talk about? Next slide, please. People want this. Many of us in this room have been there before, and they know when this was very successful. Many people in this room are seeing the revitalization of this. They're like, oh my goodness, this is so cool. But what do we need to do to get to this versus the previous slide? Next slide, please. So these are the five areas that I'm going to talk about. I'm going to just highlight briefly some of the successes on what they're doing, touch on a little bit of the challenges, and then some of the strengths that these neighborhoods have that they are building on to help revitalize their small neighborhood retail boutique stores. So we're going to talk about the Fifth Street Arcades. Next slide, please. 2012, 49 storefronts, of the 49, 20 were vacant with a vacancy of 41%. There was nothing going on after 5 o'clock if you went in here. As a matter of fact, most of the people used this as connector space during really hot days or when it was raining or snowing. I think there were actually more ghosts than shoppers that were in this place until this year. Next slide. New vision, what is happening in 2013? It is no longer called the Euclid Colonial Arcades. It has been rebranded called the Fifth Street Arcades. This has been a partnership with Cumberland Development, City of Cleveland, Charterwood Bank, and Downtown Cleveland Alliance, which many of the representatives are here today for this. So what was the formula? What was the formula to start to make this change? If any of you have not been in there, I'm going to tell you about some of the things that are happening. But it was incentives, loans, forgivable loans, grants, below market rate, rent, and creativity. Those are the key things that are really changing the Fifth Street Arcades. Next slide, please. On May 9th, there was a kickoff to celebrate winners. They had a competition for entrepreneurs that wanted to go into the Fifth Street Arcades to take their business, their idea, to get this creative funding, lower rent. Here were some of the new businesses that were awarded some of the grants, including businesses that did get grants that decided to go into the space. Next slide, please. Here's a couple of the people. Bright Green, which is a boutique jewelry making handmade soap, baby gifts, and other organic and natural themed products. And then Soulcraft, a partnership that is making reclaimed wood and furniture. Next one. Events, also attracting events. They had Fashion Week here that brought hundreds of people there after 5 o'clock, but this place was just not used. Utilize this great building and great space in this building. Okay. Gordon Square Arts District, this is the segment of the neighborhood they just want to touch base in. Over the last 10 years, over $500 million has been invested in storefronts, retail, housing, including some of the other assets that they have with the theater district, theater streetscape improvements. Creativity, attracting, offering, drawing. These are all things, actions that are part of this Gordon Square district that has also helped make and change the viability of the streetscape and the neighborhood. Walkability cafes, locally owned restaurants. I think this is synonymous almost pretty much in every neighborhood. Locally owned cafes and restaurants where you're taking people with their talents and putting it into the storefronts of businesses and making locally grown food versus some of the chains. I mean, think about it. Think if you were to go here, would you want the initiative to go there and take people from out of town or yourself if Fridays, Chili's, McDonald's, newest, whatever it is that they may have, or something there. Now, it's the locally grown food being in cafes. Gypsy beans for here. I think this is the ground zero of where everything started with Gypsy beans. Nicole Gelada, in 2007, she was one of the first recipients of the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program, and she started the coffee shop there at the corner of Detroit 65th, and she is still in business. And then some of the other businesses. We have Spice Kitchen and Bar, who was Cleveland Magazine. Oh, no, you're good. Silver Spoon Award recipient. If you haven't been there, amazing restaurant. He practices what he preaches. Locally grown food. He also has a rooftop garden that he uses. They're also a recipient of the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program. Focusing on the theaters. The theaters, that is the big gem that they have in the neighborhood. Again, to the point that was mentioned earlier, bringing in people from outside the neighborhood to go to a show, and of course they're walking around, they're seeing the neighborhood restaurants and cafes and shops that have opened up. Here's a couple of other neighborhood retail boutique and a restaurant, Lux. Again, one of the early ones that was there. I think they opened up in 2008. They are still in business. Again, public art and streetscape improvements, widening sidewalks. The street was redone a few years ago. This has made a huge impact for walkability to the neighborhood. Waterloo District. We just did a 2.5 hour walking tour there yesterday, taking an inventory of all the buildings. And this is another neighborhood that's got some great bricks and mortar restaurants, some visionaries, some ideas with the CDC, the development community coming in with some financial assistance to help make some changes to this neighborhood. Some of the things that they're focusing on is utilizing artists and getting grants and stuff to utilize and renovate these buildings to have live workspace for the artists. That is really making a change. That's their focus there with the Waterloo District. Again, with some of the funding that they're doing here, Alan Glazen with some of his vision on what he's done in West 25th over Detroit Shoreway, Crock Box, that's going to be the restaurant that's opening up over there. Again, taking walkability with the bones and of the bricks and mortar of the existing buildings that many of them are vacant, and then putting them back into productive use. And then pulling in an asset of the community. The Beachman Ballroom has been there a long time. Again, opportunity for people who are coming into this neighborhood, seeing this, instead of just getting to the Beachman Ballroom, why not getting there 2 hours before a concert and going to and getting a bite to eat or a beer. One of the missing things though is parking. Parking in many of the neighborhoods needs to be done, but let's do it right. Putting a bioswell into this and into this parking and providing it, making it public parking for all the residents to attend small businesses. Buckeye neighborhood. The Buckeye neighborhood's got a long history of having jazz, a lot of jazz clubs. So what Buckeye has done is they incorporate public art. Public art is huge in the Buckeye neighborhood, and they've taken their past and incorporated with much of this into the neighborhood. There's the Buckeye Merchants Association, which is their viable organization. They have over 200 jobs with many of the merchants. Again, most of the buildings are still there in the neighborhood. Utilizing the assets, you know, St. Luke's is going to be a residential. This former hospital is the housing, getting more people back into the neighborhood to help support much of the retail businesses that are there in the neighborhood. This is an older road to the previous one with the change of hands and the current one. Again, some more pictures of incorporating public art everywhere. I mean, I think if anybody does the public art, it's Buckeye, I think, does it the best they've done it, honestly. The buildings, the sidewalks, even the trash cans. They've done local artists that have incorporated public art. A couple more examples here. There's an animal lover, so I had the dog, the public art of the dog that's there for you to know me. A couple of neighborhood institutions that are there. Nikki's Music. If you need to find any kind of old music that has been around, go to Nikki's Music. I mean, it is there. Just an institution that is there. He's got photos of all the people who have made music that it's everywhere. So there it is, again, linking in a neighborhood institution into the Buckeye neighborhood. And I have to tell you, this is something I did now, and the reason why I put this up here, the number one beauty supply. This is, again, a draw where any of the hair salons, wig stores, where they need to go to get their makeup, hair, this is the place to go. This is almost like a Walmart of hair products. I know I didn't want to use that word, but it truly is, you know, of this. And the place is amazing. So again, from all over, suburban and Cleveland, come in there, these hair salons, to get their products there, a neighborhood asset. And one of the other things that they've done is urban farming in the neighborhood on utilizing vacant lots. Here's a couple examples of bringing in, using, making local, growing local produce. Vision for tomorrow. There's an asset here at Moreland Theater. What to do with it? And that's, Tracy gave you guys homework. Here's some homework. What to do with this asset for the Moreland Theater? Think of ideas on what to do with this, this great building. And then the last neighborhood I want to briefly touch base on is the Asiantown District. The Asiantown Center was a former industrial facility not too far from here. For many of you who have never been there, go there. It's, it has a grocery store in it, a lot of Asian shops. It's a two-level retail district there. It's amazing. This also utilized the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program and some other funding through the city to make this happen. Again, this was a former industrial site and taking these buildings and putting them back into productive use in the neighborhood. A couple of success stories with small businesses here. Coco Bakery and the Siam Cafe. Siam Cafe is one of my favorites. If you haven't been there, it has great Thai food. Local neighborhood businesses. Siam Cafe has been there for quite some time. Coco Bakery, I think, has been there about 3 years now. Here's a few more examples of some of the merchant stores that have been gone through some renovation here. Here's a mixed use. Here's an idea of a great example of a mixed use space of a building that has completely transformed over the last year and a half.
Okay, I'm going to just briefly go over some of the financing assistance that is offered through the city and through some of our partners that can help people establish some retail businesses. First and foremost is the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program, which Kevin spoke about briefly. The program was established in 2006 to help address some of the retail needs in the city. The goals include fostering entrepreneurship, improving vitality of neighborhoods, helping to create a sense of space, and job creation. Small businesses are the number one job creators in the country. Okay, so what this program can do is to help provide gap financial assistance to retailers and restaurants in the city of Cleveland. The assistance can go directly to the retailers, or it could also help developers to who have already identified a tenant that they might be putting in there. The assistance can go up to $40,000 at a 3% interest rate. There is some partial forgiveness given for sustainable initiatives, which are encouraged in the projects. And some of the uses for the funds: construction and renovation, machinery and equipment, furniture, fixtures, and signage. And there's all of these pictures are different businesses that have received financing through that through the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program. Another program we have is the Vacant Property Initiative, local parking needs, and as Kevin was talking about in the Waterloo neighborhood, establishing some parking there. We did help to fund two parking lots, which will be they'll be starting construction on those soon. And part of the reason that this program exists is to establish, to help with the parking needs in neighborhoods. Some of the neighborhoods are old building stock and it's very tight, and each individual building doesn't have their own parking. So if maybe there's a vacant lot that could be used for parking that could be shared in that in the neighborhood, it makes it easier for visitors coming in to find a space. And so what we can do in that program is provide a forgivable loan, $70,000 maximum, up to 25% of the total project cost. And this is the same picture Kevin showed, this bioswale incorporated into the project. So those kind of elements are encouraged because not only do you want to provide parking, but you want to enhance the neighborhood and you know, make it look better. The storefront renovation program, this is a program offered through community development, and I know some people are here from community development. And what they do is a rebate program, and it's there's certain depending on the neighborhoods, they can generally provide a 40% rebate up to $25,000 for exterior construction. They also provide a free design service to to people looking to renovate the buildings. So this also is on Waterloo. It's been quite a transformation of just a vacant building into a barbecue restaurant, which is directly across from the Beachland Ballroom. So you know, some of the benefits here are bringing storefronts back into code compliance, reusing historical buildings, bringing them back to their original luster, and just improve the overall shopping district in the city.
Before we get started, I wanted to formally express our appreciation to Director Nichols for her leadership, vision, and most importantly, her partnership as we move forward to address the challenge of creating sustainable urban retail in the neighborhood parks, which is their retail center. I think that this represents a turning of the corner to have a partnership with someone like Director Nichols and her staff in our efforts. And we look forward to working together to develop exciting innovations and programs in the arena of urban retail. Some of us have been at this for a long time, some are relatively new to the field, but I know we all are going to come away with new insights, ideas, and energy to keep moving forward. There's a lot of expertise in the room today. Our charge is to use it. Talking about expertise, our speakers for this session will be sharing their knowledge about the foundation or the building blocks of creating an urban retail attraction plan. They're going to be talking about some research and marketing issues. I'm going to introduce our first speaker very briefly. The biographies are in the book. Randy Markowitz is a fixture in the urban retail arena, and he has been involved in brokerage for over 25 years, and we are now going to hear his words of wisdom.
Morning, everybody. Kevin had showed a picture earlier regarding the Buckeye Area Beauty Salon. I actually brought them in the Cleveland. That was an old Woolworth space that we had rehabbed for them. And I am a customer. He's been giving me volumizing for my hair. I would definitely go over there. I have about 2 million square feet worth of retail that I currently lease. 70% of my work is entering suburbs and city sites in northeastern Ohio. I represent tenants from down to Save a Lot Foods and your favorite Family Dollar up to Steinmart, and we do tenant rep with national chains. But to talk about this, it's our first slide here. Right. We're going to talk about just defining your market area. What is your market? Are you community? Are you regional? Is it a little eclectic? You have to kind of really determine what your area is first before you present it to any prospective retailer. You have to determine the true trade area. What are your demographics? What are your medium incomes? What's your percentage of education? The retailers look at that. They will also run their own demographics. So you have to be true to them. A lot of them do not want to see these crazy trade areas that you drop 20 miles when it's not realistic. You have to give them a realistic trade area, and that, you know, helps them. Examine the pedestrian traffic, which coincides a lot with the parking issues that a lot of these areas have. If there's a good pedestrian traffic, the retailers look at that. A lot of the retailers I work with love pedestrian traffic. They do very well in those type of areas. And then you have to highlight your traffic generators in the area, whether it's hospitals, restaurants, whatever it may be. The retailers do look at that.
Next slide.
Thank you. One of the biggest complaints I get from a lot of retailers is they're sent either a shopping center or a land parcel for them to look at, but the homework hasn't been done on that. And you need to do your homework. They don't want to do the work. You have to make sure it's zoned, there's any environmental issues, what the price is it really available? The worst thing you can do to these retailers is to just send them a blank package saying, we want you to come into our area. You have to show them specifics. The conversation regarding this, trying to develop an area, would actually go to a developer first before you send it to the retailer. But that's one of their pet peeves. So in your area, you know, are you you marketing storefront, strip center, land? You have to figure out what you're marketing. There are a couple people talking about that. Parking is just a major issue with any, at least the nationals and obviously the locals. So how do you create more parking? I've seen some areas that have torn down some commercial space in between two buildings to create some additional parking in between. Earlier they mentioned creating larger parking lots, but that's important just to recognize. When you also go to the retailer, tell them what incentives up front you have, what, if anything, goes with those incentives. Just be straightforward with them, but you have to do your research before you send it to them.
Next one, thank you.
How do you find retailers? Everybody drives around, everybody goes shopping. You see a retailer you want. Before you call a retailer, analyze what that retailer is looking for. If you see a retailer in a lifestyle center, and it's a great retailer, you like them, but go online. They might be the only lifestyle centers. You're not going to call them for a community center. You waste your time, you waste their time. What I do when I lease properties is I think I hit this first by categories. What category is missing? You know, whether it's restaurants, apparel, cellular phone, whatever it may be, what are you missing in your area? Drive to similar areas. You can go to trade shows to pick up some of the national tenants. You just have to be creative. One thing I can't emphasize enough is to drive other areas. Not just in Cleveland, go to Akron, go to Canton, these are viable cities. You can see what retailers are working in certain areas. And you open your mind, drive similar type of areas. If your incomes are X, drive to a similar area in Akron and the incomes are X. And you just have to be realistic in that.
Next slide, thanks.
The national retailers will get 100 packages a day of properties to look at. And they really want just concise information. They want obviously a map showing where it is, basic demographics, a site plan, just a land parcel, and then like an overall map showing where it is in the trade area. If you start throwing too much fluff in with them, it just gets lost. They tear up these things. They just want to keep it very simple. They'll have 4 pages of information for each site. They don't want a 20-page book. And I'm talking more community-based, just regular retail. I'm not talking high-end mixed use. This is a new center I started leasing. We're called West Town Shopping Center. I'm just going to try to show you what we've done with the plan. The aerials are nice and marked. We find those very useful for people to realize what you know the trade area is.
Next slide.
You want to clean up your site plan, very specific. Retailers need to know width of all the spaces, depth, and obviously who the tenants are in the center because that's their co-attraction. Looking at the center, I guess we can talk about another little subject. You see in the corner of the shopping center, there's a large space. We have a tenant that's vacating. That's going to be a tough space to lease, so what I've thought about is I don't think I could probably get a conventional retailer to go in there. So I made a list one day of every medical thing use I can think of, and we're actually moving ahead with one of the local hospital groups to take that. I literally just made phone calls for one day, finally reached somebody, but that was thinking outside the box. The owner wanted just regular retail, but now that I brought him a hospital use, he likes the rental screen, obviously, and it would be a good reuse for this area and this community.
Next slide.
These are the areas I talked about. This one actually is not as detailed, but I thought it should have been. But you mark all the competition, all the major streets, all the associated retail in the area, and the retailers need to do that when they come in the market and they're doing it themselves. So if you can do the work for them, that's why you're marketing them. Do the work for the retailers. We just talked about this, but I think you have to think outside of the box. I brought in, is there anybody familiar with Broadway? Some of you are, Slum Village was an old Kmart there I was working on. Actually, some of my best projects I worked on. We ended up putting Metro Health in there. cut off the corner of the building so they had a drive aisle for patients to go there, but that would still be vacant. You never would have got a larger retailer there. So I thought that was a good use of creative space to do so. It was one of my better projects I worked on. We talked earlier about parking problems. And sometimes to get a retailer to come into a market, you have to be extremely aggressive if they're doing something that's out of their box. You know, can you do short-term leases? Is there any financial incentive you can give them? And I think you just really, you have to start thinking outside the box versus just conventional retail. The retail industry has changed to all nationals in the shopping centers, and there's fewer and fewer of them. And you run out of choices. Some areas do have too much retail built. There's not enough retailers to fill it. So you have to go non-retail. And I think we all get too focused on just a specific retailer when there are some great non-retail type of tenants.
Our next speaker is Keith Hamulak. And Keith also has many years of experience in the retail brokerage arena, and he has worked with some CCs as well. And he is going to share some insights on research and presentation.
Good morning, thank you for the warm welcome. The title of the presentation is What Are Retailers Looking For and How Can I Prepare My Neighborhood? The seminar's objective is to educate community stakeholders regarding the retailer site selection process and to assist community development organizations with the retailer solicitation process. Here's the outline. We're going to start at 50,000 square feet at the macro level. We're going to talk about the market, the trade area, and then we'll talk about the micro level, site-specific characteristics of the site. We're going to talk about marketing strategies that I found to be successful that you can emulate. We're going to have a list of active retailers for you, and we're going to talk about how to negotiate with national and regional tenants. Okay, let's start at 50,000 feet, understanding the trade area. It's very important to understand the trade area and define that for any prospect that you're chasing. You do that through polygons, drive time maps, whatever medium possible that you want to create to identify the geographic boundaries of a specific trade area, you can utilize. But you need to start there in order to understand the demographics of the neighborhood you're speaking about. Okay, so what you can see is we had a retailer come to us. They wanted to be in the suburbs. They wanted to be in the major trade areas. This is not just suburb specific. You can do this for urban locations. But they gave us, we gave them the intersections, and they said, we know that our customers come about 15 minutes or will drive 15 minutes to the store location. So we picked the intersections, and you can see from this map, we identified the trade area through the drive times. And now we can come up with the demographics and all the information necessary to define that trade area. Okay, we talked about the geographic, defining the trade area. The demographics will come from the trade area that you define. Obviously very important, that shows the household incomes, the population densities, the average age. There's also the socioeconomic factors that are interested to retailers, specifically incomes, education, and occupation. Very important for them to understand what those factors are in any particular trade area. We did this for a client of ours. If you want to zoom down a little bit or shrink it, this was a client called Beal Bank. They were chasing a certain customer. It was a 55 older customer that made a certain income threshold. And you can see the darker the areas, the larger density of that particular demographic that they wanted. So we ended up putting them on Richmond Road. You can see this is the hot area. But these visual aids are just pretty pictures that allow us to help sell and market the what we're trying to achieve here. It's just another medium. Radius rings, which I'll have on the next slide, work fine, but it's very important to define. area. Most recently, location analytics are coming into play big time. We're seeing this with the federal government right now and NSA and Spine, but these resources have been out to retailers for a significant amount of time. Prism and Buxton have been providing location analytical data for retailers for a long time. I would say 85-90% of national retailers use location analytics. Basically, what location analytics does is it takes these factors up here, the demographic and socioeconomic factors, and it combines them with point-of-sale data and other information, proprietary information that the retailer uses, puts it in an algorithm, spits out where they should be. And it's very sophisticated. I'm not doing it any justice, but the reality is the majority of retailers are using that location analytics to identify long-term sustainable retail locations. Okay, secondly, we define the trade area. Now we need to define the anchor. Who's bringing or generating traffic to a specific trade area? We've got a couple of pictures of a couple anchors. They don't have to all be retail-oriented. Up here we have the Westside Market in Ohio City, and down below there is the Board Federal Headquarters Building and the Broadway Slavic Village anchors. Both of those create traffic for the trade area. Different consumers identify the type of customers or employees that are there, and then you can identify retailers that can meet the needs of those particular employees or customers. Spatial maximization. This is critical to understand the concept of this. If you want to move the map, retailers look at a market, and if it's a public company, they need to tell Wall Street how many stores they can build. So they need to identify and understand how many stores can Northeast Ohio support. Spatial maximization helps them do that. We did this for a client that's opening up WAC centers throughout Northeast Ohio. They gave us their minimum demographics. We found areas that met those minimum thresholds. They also like Massage Envy as a co-tenant, so we plotted them as well. And you can see now, from a corporate standpoint, they can say, I can build 8 to 10 stores, or from a franchise standpoint, if it's a franchisor, they even know how many franchises they can sell. They now have an idea of what the market can support. Radius restrictions. So you know of a retailer, Randy said, driving to other neighborhoods that meet or have similar demographics to yours is critical. It's how I still do it today. It's absolutely critical. So you identify a retailer that might be in the neighboring community, and you think, wow, they would be awesome here. Well, likely they may not want to put another location within a mile, you know, cannibalization of sales and so forth. So what you got to understand is, how is that store performing? You want to reach out to the decision maker and find out, is that store doing poorly? Is it doing very good? Could they support another store? Is it a relocation candidate? So understanding radius restrictions, understanding spatial maximization will help you when you're making that phone call, make educated statements to the decision maker, ask the right questions. It's going to help you in the long term. Okay, we looked at the trade area and the market, and now we're looking at the site specific. We've identified the trade area, we want to be there. Now we need to identify the site. The physical characteristics of the site are important. In the city of Cleveland, the centers that were built in the 40s and the 50s had long bay depths, 100 feet of depth, 115 feet of depth. Tracy's experience at Garrett Square, and she understands now that retailers don't want any more than 80 foot of depth. They want 20 feet of frontage and 80 foot of depth, and that's the prototype, and that's what works. If you get outside that box, you just have to sell harder. But understand that you know, they do have prototypes that work for them. Visibility is absolutely critical as well. There's a picture down here of Cam's Corner. I love what they did. They had a streetscape project and some trees were planted, but notice that they didn't put it right in front of the restaurant. They kept the sight lines so that the restaurant signage isn't affected. We don't have the luxury of monument and pylon signs in the urban areas to have that type of signage. So they did very well with that. I was talking about signage. This is a picture from Ohio City. One of the restaurants felt the need to have this additional signage. So and the CDC was very flexible. Tremont was the same thing. You put the sign out right next, you know, at the tree lawn when they open for business, and at the end of the day, they take it in. Little programs like that help the retailer with their signage issues. And parking, obviously, we talked about that. On-street parking is not the preferred method of parking. If you can go through the right-of-way, if you can have parking directly in front of the store, it's critical. Retailers don't want the parking in the back of the building. They just don't want that exposure. Let's talk about consumer shopping patterns, because it's very important to understand vehicle traffic counts. Retailers are going to want to know how many cars are passing a specific intersection on any given day, or what's passing the building on any given day. If you have low vehicle counts, but you have a more walkable neighborhood, like 65th Detroit neighborhood, figure out bike counts, pedestrian counts, whatever. Understand how many people are passing the storefront that you're proposing on any given day. And then what side of the street I am. What side of the street am I on? Most people don't know that there are two sides of the street. I'm going to give you an example. I'm going north out West 25th. I'm at the intersection of Lorraine and West 25th, and I'm going north on West 25th. I'm on the east side of the street. Am I on the AM side of the street, or am I on the PM side of the street? I'm going to ask that question. I'm going to raise your hands. PM side of the street? I'm on the east side of the street, going north on West 25th. AM side of the street? Okay, good. You get it. Starbucks wants to be on the AM side of the street. They don't want their customers making a left and another left and a left out. So it's important to understand what the location you're proposing, what side of the street is it on. And then near corner, front corner. In the 90s, felt like a corner was a corner with the drugstores building as much as they did, but there is a difference. It's important to understand that the far corner is the more desirable of the two corners. Obviously, the near corner is the potential for the backup on the main artery. So when the cars park at the traffic signal, the potential on the near corner is that the cars can queue and back your access or block your access to your driveway. So in terms of near corner, far corner, just understanding that concept and understanding that far corner is more desirable will help you in your marketing efforts. Okay, next slide. These are some resources. These are basically the commercial MLS resources, CoStar, FluidNet, and Xelligent. You want to be very familiar with them. If you don't have access to them, all the major brokerages do. I'm sure we'd be happy to help you with that, pulling property information for you to give you some comps. There's some retail, in terms of other resources, here's some periodicals. All of those are available at the library or online. They'll just give you ideas on who to pursue and what type of concepts are hot. Yogurt's hot again, you know. I mean, PCBY, we thought they would never come back, but Menchie's is blowing up and opening up a ton of locations. So these periodicals just give you an idea of who's hot. Next slide. So how do I find the national retailers and the person to contact? Three databases that are phenomenal. They save me a ton of time. All three are very good. I have an example of Retail Lease Track on here. Gives me the decision maker's name, his phone number, his address. You can Google it, it's just going to take you more time. This is a resource that helps you expedite the process to find the key decision maker. So you definitely want to look at that. And how do I find local retailers and principals' names? Well, we have the Cranes Business Journal, the grand opening section. The Cuyahoga County Auditor has a website for vendor licenses. I'll show you an example of that. And then just if they have an existing location, call the store. Ask for the manager. Ask for the decision maker, talk to them, and you'll have some success. So like I was saying, the best practices, the most successful brokers and companies, property owners use multiple mediums. You gotta use them all. Sign, internet, TV, not TV, but periodicals and newspapers. As many mediums as you can use, you're gonna have a higher chance of success. Exposure is the name of the game. And affiliate with trade organizations like ICSC, your Chamber of Commerce, and get involved in the philanthropic and social service organizations in your neighborhood. Randy said it earlier, he's putting those non-traditional uses into retail buildings, and certainly being affiliated with those organizations is a positive for your neighborhood. The perfect package, you know, they look at thousands of packages, and these real estate directors are typically compensated by the number of stores they can open. So you got to make his job as easy as possible. I think that's it. But in closing, I just want to reiterate, be flexible, be creative. There's no better time to be in the city of Cleveland right now. Retailers went out to the suburbs. They were banking on this huge growth explosion that never happened. And so now they're focusing back on the first spring suburbs in the city of Cleveland. And it's your time to capitalize on that. Thank you.
Well, I really want to thank you all for inviting me out here. I have actually never been to Cleveland until yesterday at 12 o'clock, and I have to say, A, I'm ready to move here, and if anybody is really astute at technology, I'm trying to figure out how to get a couple of my gas tanks full of gas home, because I'm paying $4.59 a gallon, you're paying $3.24. So if I can figure, if anybody can help me figure out how to get that on the plane tonight, let me know. So if it was coming the other way, they'd never let me on the plane. So I'm going to try to coordinate this, and I apologize. If you guys can't hear me, generally people can hear me without a mic. Let me know. I tend to talk with my hand, unlike the two gentlemen that spoke earlier. I have a lot of hair. I did go to that Walmart Beauty Products, and because I'm in D.C., usually it's about out of here, so we try to pull it back a little bit for you. So, okay, so if I just wave, you know, this is my Vanna White for the morning, so. Anyway, what I do, I'm going to walk you through a little bit of an overview of what's going on in the market and what we're seeing happening in retail, because there's really been a tremendous change in the last decade. You know, if many of you were working in real estate or were managing a CDC or a neighborhood area, you know, in the early part of the 2000 decade, it was an amazing time. The brokers were making a ton of money, retailers were making a ton of money, and, you know, 2006, 7, 8, the world just crashed. In the process of that world crashing, it has really changed the dynamics of what's happened in the retail world. You know, the economy is still soft. My town is doing incredibly well. You know, and actually, we look at rankings all the time, and I may argue with you on some of how you all compare. And I think D.C. has got a few of those world rankings for drinking, as well as a few world rankings for things we don't talk about. But it's understanding what is going on, and I think that Keith talked about it really well, as did Randy, is understanding how the retailers are thinking about what's happening in the market. So let you slip tie. This is really just kind of my list of, you know, kind of like our short list of what we try to get people to understand. And urban markets are hot. The millennial population is really starting to look at urban markets. You know, the empty nesters are coming back to urban markets. And there's a lot of reasons for that. And this is a trend that's happening across the country. This trend is actually influencing what's happening with retailers. If I'm blocking this, let me know. The Pew Foundation in Washington just did a study on millennials, and what they found is that 64% of millennials want to live in urban markets, they want to live in mixed-use developments, and they want a market that's walkable, dense, where they can shop, eat, and play. They're willing to trade space, they're willing to trade their car to have that environment. And we're finding that retirees are taking the same approach. They no longer want that 4,000 square foot house. They want to be in a much smaller space where they can walk to all of their amenities. That's having a huge impact on what the retailers are doing, as well as what's happening in the shift of demographics. The Hispanic population, which is growing, and my memory is, I think it's 2050, 2030. I mean, I probably won't be standing at that time, but they're going to be a predominant market in this United States, and the retailers are already starting to shift how they look at markets, what they're doing, and how they're merchandising the markets. And there are developments that are just either Hispanic. We've got Asian developers that are popping up around the country. All of these types of factors are really shaping what retailers do. And I think the biggest thing is retailers are changing their prototype. And this is where Keith and Randy and I may not all agree on things, and some of it is the pressure on the East Coast sometimes, or the West Coast is a little bit different than the Midwest, and communities that are, you know, tier B cities, if you will, like Cleveland, that are starting to come back and emerge, but they're changing their footprint. And a really good example, Target and Walmart. You know, Walmart is the evil word, if you will. And I don't, do you all feel about Walmart like the East Coast feels about Walmart? I mean, do you have this like, oh God, it's Walmart? Okay? Yeah. But you know what? Walmart has a population of consumers that many of them, depending on which part of the country you're in, the average household income of a Walmart shopper is over 80,000. You know, Costco. People think Costco is an evil word in Washington, D.C. The average household income of Costco customers 7 years ago was 110,000.
So, you know, understanding those issues about the retailers is key. But Target and Walmart have both taken their footprints. They're going from 150, 180 square feet because they want to be in urban markets, and they're learning how to adapt to those urban markets. And that's something we're going to look at later on. You'll see some of the slides that will show you some really interesting concepts of how they've adapted to these markets. And I'm not going to go long time, but I wanted to give you kind of an overview of the state of the industry. And this is really what we've been looking at for the last couple of years. On the next couple of slides, where you want to look is right here. And this is where we're trending. We're finally starting to see stability coming back up. And actually, and I'm sorry, Keith has left, but one of the things I looked at was CBRE does national market reports, and they'll look at a micro market. Cleveland is one of the markets they've looked at. They've actually identified Cleveland as one of the markets over the next 3 years that they're seeing that are emerging. And it's interesting because it was Cleveland, I think Sacramento, Charlotte. It's really these tier B cities. These cities, it's not Washington, Philly, and New York. It's that next tier where the growth is starting to happen. And this one is, again, this is one of my favorite slides because it's almost looking like at an EKG. This is what was going on with sales. And, you know, I think Randy mentioned the issue of public company. They have a certain performance metric that they have to meet. They have to open the number of stores. And this is what was going on with their sales figures, but it's starting to correct. It's finally starting to stabilize. And we don't have the numbers because these tend to be a little bit, probably about 3 months behind, but the anecdotal information we're getting is that sales are still up and they are staying stably up. And it's interesting if you look at the categories because it's in specialty retail, it's in luxury retail, and part of that is the international travel that's taking place because of the exchange rate that's going on. And then it is going back to your neighborhood goods and services. So these are the kinds of things that we pay attention to. And then this is another slide, it's a little bit fun. It was published in something that ICSC does, and it just kind of gives you a snapshot of where vacancy rates are, what types of centers are doing better than other centers. And this is the kind of data that we look at on a regular basis. Brokers are looking at this, and the retailers are looking at this. And I think it was Keith who made the comment that, you know, they look at a lot of data. Every retailer I know, whether it, you know, all the national really, they look at every single, you know, subscription report. They get something called Claritas, they get Esri, they'll get the Boston reports, they get all of the brokerage reports, they synthesize this, and then they also all have their own research groups in-house. Container stores, like probably the easiest one to talk about. You all familiar with Container Store? About a year ago, they had 49 stores. The head of real estate for Container Store can tell you her average customer is 41. She lives 20 minutes from her store. When she does come to that store, she'll, on average, every like 18 months, she will probably spend $1,100. Part of that $1,100 is going either to their college students, buying containers that are going into those college dorms, or she happens to live in an older house that has really crappy closets. And it's fascinating. Every time I go to the Container Store, I email and say, I just spent $1.19, I've just blown your metrics. Because I don't shop. I spend so much time in stores, I just don't shop. But she knows her market so well. They do so much research. They do back research on their credit card sales. They're able to gauge exactly where the market is, who their customer is, and what kind of demographic has to be in their market. And that's a really good example because I think she has a better handle on her stores and her customer base than anybody I've ever heard. And part of it's because she's got 49 stores. I think they actually went up about 53 this year. But it's understanding who your customer is. And this is what's important for communities. It really is important to understand what that market is. It's understanding the fundamentals of real estate. Whether it is a CVS, whether it's a local coffee shop, and Keith made a very good point about are you on the AM side of the street or the PM side of the street? And you put me on the PM side of the street, I guess, because I had to cross the street to get my coffee at 6 o'clock this morning. But those kinds of issues and those kinds of elements are key to understanding retail and bringing retail to your neighborhood. And part of the thing that is really also key is understanding the roles in retail. And I always tell people, I do work with the city of Philadelphia, and I do it for the Business Improvement District. Are any of you familiar with Philly? It's the downtown. It's kind of like the downtown part of Cleveland. But we also do work for an organization that is essentially the Economic Development Department of the city. And my role is very distinct. We have the marketeers, which are the bid people, and they do great creative work. We have brokers in town, and they're the worst brokers I've ever dealt with. And not that they don't know what they're doing, they don't work well together. And part of it is because they were never as desperate as like a market like Washington, D.C., where 15 years ago, I guess it was 18 years ago, you couldn't buy a hammer in the city of D.C. You could buy a sheet for $350 or about $9 a set, and you didn't want the $9 set. That's how bad D.C.'s retail market was. So the brokers in Washington worked together. Philadelphia, they don't work together. I mean, it's like, you know, dealing with pirates on a daily basis. But my role is very distinct. I'm the interloper. I'm the bad guy. And I'm the one that when the broker tells you, and I think Tracy made a good point, that they're there to make a living. And sometimes they will take that shorter path because either they represent the tenant, they know the tenant will go in, they don't have to think about it, they can put them in like that. I'm the bad guy. I'm the woman that calls the head of Bloomingdale's and say, you know, you really ought to be looking here, and here's why. And then I piss off the brokers. I piss off the broker's brokers. And as my comment is, but I don't get paid. You're still making the commission. So I know what my role is, and they all blame me in Philadelphia. So that's also key. In your neighborhood, you need to understand, are you the marketeer? Are you the guy that's driving that clean and safe? Or are you the person that's going to pick up the phone and sell your neighborhood? And understanding that is key, as well as understanding what you're doing with the research.
I think she's got my rhythm down here, right? You just watch me flip pages.
So I'm not used to having Dan away, so this is kind of fun. Creating a vision, and Randy talked about that a little bit, as did Keith. It's really creating that vision for your neighborhood, and it's understanding what your neighborhood is. And this is a very difficult thing to do sometimes in a neighborhood. You've got a lot of eclecticity in Cleveland from what I could see yesterday. We only saw 14 neighborhoods. And I did a little bit of research before I came out here. But, and you'll see as we go further down, you know, some of my presentation, it's really understanding what that neighborhood is. Understanding who the character, you know, who's the character of your neighborhood. And I say that, is it creatives? Is it the hippies? I mean, I saw hippies. I saw a hippie neighborhood yesterday. We don't have hippie neighborhoods left in Washington, D.C. You know, we've got some other neighborhoods that we won't talk about, but we have foodie neighborhoods in Philly, and it's where the foodies are moving into. So it's understanding that. One of the things that's key is if you have a vision, is selling that vision. It's selling it to your brokers. It's selling that vision to your residents. Getting people to embrace it. Selling it to your property owners. And that is probably the most difficult thing you can do. And, you know, many of the neighborhoods have absentee landlords. If you can't reach your landlord, get somebody who's managing the property. Get the tenant that's on the second floor who can put a little pressure on the landlord. One of the things we did in Philadelphia is we created a roadshow, and it was very simple. It was kind of who we are, what we can do for you, and what we see down the road. And that we've actually taken that roadshow to every single broker. We've taken it to every neighborhood community that supports the downtown district, and we've taken it to major landlord groups. And you know, Philadelphia's downtown is a little bit more dense than yours is at this point, but it's a very diverse audience, and we have a lot of international owners. We have a lot of New York owners, so it's been very difficult to reach them. You know, some of them just don't care. We've got five blocks in a row in the main corridor downtown that are vacant, and the landlords just don't care. You know, most of them own the property. The only thing they're paying is the taxes, and the taxes have not been reassessed, so they just don't care. So it was reaching them was really difficult, and we did it electronically. I think we kind of annoyed the crap out of them. But you know, I'm sorry, you know, I'm using phraseology like that. I'm a DC kitty, you know. So, but that is one of the biggest things you can do, and get them on board, get them to agree with it. We work in a small community in Virginia. We were having a really difficult dichotomy with what the residents wanted, what the supervisors or your council wanted. So we did a survey, and we put a simple survey up on the local newspaper. We got 193 responses. It was amazing, because it turned out everybody had the same idea of what they wanted for retail. We've now taken that, we're using it to market to retail, and then we've taken that, and we've now given it to the brokers, and we've given it to the landlords. So it was a slightly different take on how to sell it, our vision, but it was able, we were able to use it to sell the vision. So how do you begin? And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. All of this will be up there. But I am a big believer in data. Is, you know, the old line in public relations is, you know, if you say it now, it's going to be backed up by facts later, or they're going to come after you. And in retail, you know, Keith said it well, they have their own research. They don't want fluff. The only thing that should be fluffy is your hair when you walk into a meeting, is what I tell people. If you don't have the real facts, these guys know it. And they will check you out. If you lie to them once, they're not going to come back. They want to know what's really the ground truth of what's going on in your neighborhood. DC is a great example. We were the murder capital of the nation for, I don't know, 12 years. You know, we made that very clear to people. So one of the metrics that we started tracking was crime, and we started tracking foot traffic of police patrols because we knew crime was an issue. And again, you think back in 1993, I couldn't shop in Washington, D.C. I really could not buy anything in Washington, D.C. So, and I used to shop. I don't shop anymore. You know, I've hit a point where I have it all. But we pushed that with these national tenants because they were like, we're not coming to Washington. The grocers weren't coming, Starbucks wasn't coming, and it was all based on that. So one of the things is doing is getting that kind of data. Some of these data points are easy to get. It's cleaning, clean and safe. It is utility bills. It's understanding what rents are, what property taxes are. Those are the kind of fundamental pieces of information that they really need. And as I said, I push data. And this is an example. We did a project. We were brought into Miami to basically reorganize a study that had been done of 27 neighborhoods. And it was under a new administration. The mayor had very lofty goals of what he wanted to do. Are any of you familiar with Miami? Okay, Coconut Grove West, which is what used to be called the Black Grove. We had an area called the Midtown Arts District. We had Little Haiti. And then we had what's now the Ballpark District. Well, the mayor had this idea that Little Haiti, this was in 2009, that he was going to turn this into this grandiose retail neighborhood. And you'll see some slides further on, a little bit that help explain what the challenges we were dealing with. But one of the things we looked at, we pulled the data, and we pulled, you'll see it on this chart, and I don't know if you can read it, it may not be real clear, but somebody had asked about walk times and drive times. This is a neighborhood that was walkable, as was Coconut Grove, as was the Midtown Arts District. And what we did was we were able to pull those drive times down to 1, 3, and 5 minutes, which are what translates into that pedestrian time. And you really have to understand your market. You have to understand the patterns, the street patterns, the traffic patterns, and where the residents are, so you understand, is it a 2-minute drive time or a 6-minute drive time? But you can do it. One of the things we found, and this is why I push data heavily and understanding what your market is, the mayor was adamant. He wanted this, he wanted this, he wanted this. We got out of our cars, we spent a couple days talking to the people on the street, and again, most of these folks had just, you know, most of them were immigrants. Many of them were multi-generational families, very different dynamic than many of the other neighborhoods in Miami. As we talked to these residents, and there was this great Caribbean marketplace, it was only open Friday, Saturday, and Sunday afternoons. It was beautiful, and I have photos, I just don't have it in the presentation, but and I'll add it to what we sent you. What we talked to them about was, you know, they wanted it open 6 days a week. They wanted the hours to be from 11 o'clock to 8 p.m. at night. As we talked to the residents, what we realized, the residents had no ambition, because the residents had come from the market, where many of them didn't have plumbing, many of them didn't have power, and they had left after what had happened with the hurricane in Haiti, and they had moved to Little Haiti. So to them, they were living in the most pristine environment. They didn't have the same level of motivation. They wanted arts, they wanted craft, and they wanted ethnic food. So what we did was we worked with the city to understand what was there, what the neighborhood could support, understanding what was in the market. How do you market that to Miami Beach? How do you market to travelers that are coming in? And so we helped them understand what the fundamental base was there and how do you sell it. And so that's where your data can really help you. And this is why we're adamant, you have to use data, whether it's even understanding on a local basis, but it helps you understand the purchasing power, it helps you understand your buying power, and it helps you understand who really is your market. And, you know, is it that snakeskin bag? Now, that snakeskin bag can do very well in Chevy Chase, Washington, D.C. It will not sell on 8th Street Northeast in Washington, D.C. And it really is understanding what that buying power is. And this kind of flips to my next image. I had an architect do this for me because about 7 years ago, you know, you knew that you had made it if you had Nordstrom's or Starbucks. And I can't tell you how many neighborhoods said, we want a Nordstrom's. And you know, you're looking at the neighborhood and it's, you know, maybe 2,000 homes. And some of them had household incomes that were below the median household income. So one of the things we work heavily with is how do people understand what you can support, what your building stock can support. Because you can't shove a Nordstrom into a neighborhood market. And I say that, and I'm going to contradict myself later on when you see some of the images, But for the most part, you cannot shut Nordstrom in a tiny little strip center or a tiny little neighborhood, you know, retail space. Same thing, Cambridge, Massachusetts. Anybody know Cambridge? They wanted Starbucks. That was going to validate them. And this came from the city. It is the only, you know the neighborhood I'm talking about in Central Square? They broke the storefront windows nonstop for like 10 straight days. The residents of Central Square, which were hippies, it's the most intercultural group I've ever met, they just stood there and stoned the Starbucks windows. And the mayor of the city wanted Starbucks because it validated Central Square, which if you're looking at Harvard is here, there's something called Porter Square is up here, and Central Square is here. And then MIT is past that. So it's an area that was an emerging neighborhood for years. It was really underdeveloped. Lower incomes. It was where you went when you couldn't afford any place else in Cambridge. It was a great neighborhood, but they didn't want Starbucks. So that's also part of understanding what your neighborhood is going to support. They finally worked it out, and the mayor helped them understand that the Starbucks would have poetry readings, and they would bring in and they'd buy from the local bakeries instead of selling the typical stuff. That's part of understanding how do you make it work. So, and Keith talked a little bit, so I'm going to walk you through a little bit about those site selection factors. And this is something from the neighborhoods you need to really pay attention to. And there is a primary trade area, there's a secondary trade area, even in a neighborhood. And as we come down, I'm going to show you a couple different maps so you can understand how you look at those trade areas. The primary trade area is really where your basic customers are coming from, and they're very different. If you are in a downtown market, like a Washington, D.C. downtown market or Manhattan, Midtown Manhattan, trade area there is going to be very different than it would be if I'm in downtown Cleveland or if I'm on 7th Street. Trade area is completely different. You need to understand your primary market, who is the people that are going to support that business on a regular basis, the secondary, and there are key indicators that you need to look at. I mean, there are certain things that they want to know all the time. They want to know your employment. They want to know household. They want to know household income. They want to know household size. And again, depending on the retailer, some markets have multi-generational families. You've got 3 and 4 generations sometimes living under a household. It's a very dense household. It can be very dense or very non-dense buying power depending on the market. You also want to look at age. As the age is dropping, generally that means you're starting to have babies, or you've got young people moving back into the neighborhood. Certain retailers like younger population. Some retailers like the older population. So understanding your age, home ownership is key. Home Depot likes home ownership, needless to say, because you're gonna come in, you're gonna renovate your home. There are other stores who don't care about that. So that's also a key metric to look at, and then the density. And we're finding, particularly in urban, even in neighborhoods, the density factor is becoming one of those issues that they're looking at. And it's not just density by household, it's density by degrees, it's density by rental, it's density by any type of retail. The density factor, kind of that heat map factor, is really becoming key. And then there's the unexpected ones, and Brookings Institution, there was a group there for years that was looking at urban markets called the Metropolitan Institute. They've done some work in Detroit, they may have done work 10 years ago here. They coined this term, the Euros, if you will. And these are non-traditional factors, 15 years ago, but in urban markets, they're key. And I listed the mom factor as one of them. It's a key issue in a place like Washington and in Philadelphia. And we saw strollers yesterday, a lot of strollers. The neighborhood I lived in Washington, it was, if you know DC at all, I lived east of 14th Street, which is the Hooker District. I was so excited. I lived in a walk-up. I bought 20 bags of Halloween candy. I ate 20 bags of Halloween candy, because we had no children in the neighborhood. I had just moved in, literally not a single person knocked on my door. A lot of drunks, a lot of homeless people, so I gave them the candy as well. We now have something called the stroller index that's being developed, and in Philadelphia, the mom factor has been key. We have almost no children retailer in downtown Philadelphia. If you need diapers, you order it online, or you drive out of the city to buy, and I'm not joking, you have to leave the city basically to buy a case of diapers. If you need a crib, you have to leave the city to buy a crib. We have Children's Place as the only retailer. So the mom factor has started to become key. And again, it's because the generation, the millennial generation, my generation, all my friends have babies at 40, 41, and even a little bit older. these kids are coming out, they want their baby now, they don't want to wait. So what we're seeing is the millennial population, the baby growth is happening, it's starting to change the texture of the retail. And in Philadelphia, we have no kid stores. So the woman had a baby, she needed a place to put him in daycare, she bought a building, she turned it into something called The Nest, and it's three stores, it's a membership, monthly membership program. You can do birthday parties there, but during the week, because again, we didn't have this, she had no place to put her kid, either before work or after work. You can come in there, you can rent it for birthday parties, it's got playgroup, it's got pre-K education, it's sold out in 27 days. And, you know, that is like phenomenal. So now they have a waiting list. So, we find the mom factor to be really important. Okay, so this is where I'm going to beat you guys up, because this is where we talk about authenticity, and I think Keith hit it, is understanding, giving them the real facts. And I use this because this picture is on the front page of the Metro section of the Washington Post, and it was like they were really taking pot shots at you guys because you were trying to pass off this for Washington, D.C. Well, that's great, but we don't have any 30-something story buildings, so anybody who's going to watch your movie, Captain America, is going to know this is not real. Okay? And we're like really having fun. Everybody in D.C. is waiting to come see this movie because we're going to like take it apart. We're going to look at it shot by shot and figure out which one's D.C. and which one's not. And Joe Maravici was talking about that yesterday, that you can start to see the things blending. But I just thought I'd have some fun with you because I guarantee that is not the Washington Monument in the back. Unless you think it's the Washington Monument. And then, you know, I can leave now. So. This is it. Talking about the trade areas, this is one of the slides I wanted to show you. This is what Keith was talking about, and this is a really good example. The ring boundary is something that's been standard for a long time. It works great in suburban markets when you've got a very large intersection and you're looking at a 5 or 10 mile ring, which is a Home Depot or a Walmart's trade area. Miami, when they asked us to do the analysis of these five neighborhoods, and again, we were correcting data that had been done, it was just they didn't understand the market, the other firm. So they said, we need you to do ring boundaries. And we argued with them, and I have the best researcher in America. She's done research for Trader Joe's for years. She was Madison Retail Group and Madison Marquette's retail research broker. She knows how to figure out a trade area by looking at maps and doing the topography, understanding street traffic volumes, and she can really define either a polygon or a walk time. So we presented the maps to Miami, we ran the data. There's a lot of fish in this park right here. These fish, they don't spend any money. And this was that the city was adamant we had to do ring boundaries because that's what retailers wanted. We had to go back in and reconfigure the trade areas. And this is one of the things in your neighborhoods. You're going to find that the ring boundary is probably not appropriate. And you probably don't need to spend a lot of money. It's really going out, even just taking a simple map, understanding a 5-block square area of where your residents are. If you've got a 3-block or a 4-block residential or commercial district, you're going to pull your primary area is going to be in that area. So, but this was a really good example of understanding the difference between the two. There's a lot of data sources, and Keith talked a lot about the different sources. So Esri and Claritas are two big data companies that provide data. It's a subscription. Or there are firms that will do it for you that pay for the subscription, so you can get it a lot better. It's something maybe Tracy could think about. If there are like 4 or 5 neighborhoods, you pay one of those firms, demographic firms, to run this data for you. This is a sales and leakage analysis, and I have this one up particularly because this is one of the things that a retailer will look at. Anything on the right is leakage. It means sales are leaving the market. Anything on the left means there's a surplus, which means consumers are coming in. And if you ever were to see one of these reports, they're very confusing. The way they're labeled is almost like a misnomer. And the interesting thing about this is not a standalone piece of data. And it's one of maybe 7 or 8 things that a retailer will look at. And it gives you a good snapshot. This is a place in Chester, PA. And we recently did an analysis for them. And we put this up and we talked to them about it. And this is in context. It's a town of 33,000. The average household income is below 23,000. All of their sales are leaving the market. And they keep telling us, we need retail. They actually told me they wanted a Whole Foods. You know, you have to be polite and explain that Whole Foods is not coming, partly because there's nobody who can afford to shop at Whole Foods. But they also have a lot of retail that surrounds this little tiny city. And I have to say, Chester's probably one of the worst cities in America. If you're not familiar with it, it's an old industrial, it's an old port city. Sunship Oil is there. They build a lot of major, major naval ships. When that market crashed, that town completely crashed. And they've got a university. It's bifurcated by I-95, the university, and a major facility, medical facility on the other side. There's almost no industry and no business on this, the east side of 95. So it's a good snapshot, but this is not necessarily a pure piece of data. In a city like DC, you probably see it almost more evenly distributed, which again gives them an understanding. And you can do this by, you can break it out by sector, you can break it out by your trade area time, and you can break it out by NAIC code. We've done this where clients are saying, well, we want food-related retail. So we can pull it out by grocers, by food out of home, which is restaurants or takeout restaurants. So really gives them, they're really trying to build up a retail base or restaurant base rather, they get a better feeling for what it is. And Keith and Randy and then the folks from the city talked about access to information. I cannot strengthen that for the neighborhoods. You've got data that's available, you've got brokers' reports that are available. You can go online, pull up, you know, Google real estate, national real estate retail brokers. Generally you can find a local market report for Cleveland. It'll give you some general background. You can go into the census, you can go into the Bureau of Labor Statistics, and then there's data soon to be at the city's website, correct? Okay, put a link on your website. You don't have to recreate the data, but make it simple for them to find. Make it easy for them to link into. I
added a couple slides. Back at the tour yesterday, I realized that some of my slides were a little bit downtown centric. So, since this is up, we'll talk about this. This is an easy source of information you can create. You can do this in an Excel sheet. We created strip maps for downtown Philadelphia. God bless them, but isn't this what interns are for, right? You're supposed to go walk the street and identify what's there, what's not there. This is not to scale, and we generally don't ever present this as to scale, but we can sit in a meeting with a local retailer, we can sit in a meeting with a broker, we'll identify what's vacant, what's available, and it, for a national tenant, which is key, and we have it for all the major retail streets, you know, and we'll put them out there, we print them out at 11 by 17 for meetings. We can sit and point and you can start to see what the juxtaposition is. It makes it very easy for them to understand. You can update this. It's a really easy piece of information. You could do this for every neighborhood so that if, you know, it's available. Just put available. You don't have to put the word vacant, which tends to have a negative connotation. But you can at least give them an understanding of what might be available. And one of the key things that people start to look at is if there's multiple spaces next to each other, you can start to build synergy and really start to effectuate change. So, again, okay. So these are some of the tools and incentives. And a gentleman in the back whose name is escaping me at the moment because I've had no sleep.
Kevin.
Kevin talked about the resources and tools that are available. Again, this is another point I'm going to emphasize. Go in and meet with the city. Find out what's there. Educate your brokers. Educate whoever it is the point person at the CDC or your neighborhood group about what's available. Key is understanding how you stack it. And I'm going to give you an example. In Philadelphia, we had a woman who was a retail designer. She did very high-end custom uniforms and shirts. She had produced in the Philippines. She decided one day, God bless her, in 2008, the market had crashed, she wanted to open a retail store. It was probably a good time because she was able to get retail space much more, you know, cost-effective. She went into the city, and she was lucky because she happened to sit down with probably the person in the city of Philadelphia who understood their financing tools better than anybody. And she said, well, here's what I want to do. What kind of working capital do you have? I don't have any available of my own capital because I'm putting it all into the manufacturing right now in the Philippines. I've just done a big order. What can I do to open a store? I need a grant. I need some low interest loans. The woman said, well, if you really want to do this, why are you manufacturing in the Philippines? And for those of you who may not be familiar with Philadelphia, it was the garment district manufacturing, you know, the capital of the United States. And we had a huge garment industry there. There's still a lot of tailors and sewers, if you will. There's sewing factories still in the city. So this woman said, all right, you want to open a retail store. We can probably help you find space. You have no money.
not never a good prospect to walk into a city office. I have no money, but I want to, if I have an idea, right? She had a business plan. She was a very, very smart woman. She had her business plan. She already had a track record in industry. What they said to her is, we'll help you open the store. We'll help you find the space. But what we want you to do is bring the manufacturing back to the United States. And if you're willing to do that, we can give you working capital. We'll build out the space for you. They were able to use industrial financing because it was, quote, manufacturing. So now she's like, if the women may know Zara, any of the women here know the store Zara, it's called just-in-time retail, they literally pick up the phone and they say, I need more eights. Eights are shipped the next day. This and that retailer has really perfected that model. That is what she's done. So on the second floor, she's got her tailors. The city also threw in workforce training, and it was another grant. So she could train some of the folks in the other sewing, in the old sewing factories that were really like starving for business, to come in and learn how to cut her patterns, understand who her market was, who her customer was. And then the city gave her a working capital grant as well. So she was able to open her store. It's doing really, really well. She brought all of her manufacturing back to the United States. So it's been a win-win. This is only because the woman at the city understood, here's an idea, we've got these tools, how do I put these tools together to make the case? And she has done incredibly well. And that's key in understanding what your tools are. In DC, we use tax increment. There's nobody here from DC, and you're not sending this to DC on that TV station, right? I've been there to get myself in trouble on occasion. I think we use tax increment in Washington, DC far too loosely. I'm a hardcore economic developer in Miami Beach. 20-something years ago, we used it to catalyze investment. DC has given tax increment financing grants and facade renovation. You know, but it's worked. It's not necessarily, in my mind, the best use of money, but it's worked. So the other thing is, okay, just making sure I'm on the right slides here, is the balance between recruitment and retention. And sometimes it's so sexy, you don't like the mix in your neighborhood, you want to bring in that big new tenant, whether it's a regional or local tenant. I urge neighborhoods all the time, whether it's a downtown or a smaller neighborhood, keep in mind the retention is equally important. You know, I think the SBA tells regularly, it's a lot easier to keep a business it is than to bring in a new business. And with retail, it's the same thing. And it's understanding, if you've got a retailer, whether they're not doing really well, or whether they don't look very well, if it's, you know, they started to get run down, if they've been there for a number of years, they probably have a customer base that you can build on. And I really urge you to work with some of those tenants and market some of those tenants. And an example of retention, again, in downtown Philadelphia, which is a little bit different than neighborhood, Middell's Sporting Goods, are you all familiar with Middell's? Middell's took over a lease. They were a subtenant of Lohmann's, which nobody understood why Lohmann's failed in downtown Philadelphia. And I'm a Saks and a Lohmann's girl. I don't really go anywhere else in between. I usually go to Saks and go buy a Lohmann's. But we found out, Middell's went in, and I knew the real estate director really well. And he confided in us and said, you know, our sales suck. We're dying. We don't know what we're going to do. And Art Middell is willing to walk away, and he's never walked away from a store. So we went out there a couple times. We went in the morning, we went in the night, we did the, you know, the PM side, and it was a one-way street, so it really wasn't an AM, PM. But we looked at it, and what we realized, nobody could see the storefront because it had been redesigned in the 70s. It was recessed. Sign code wasn't allowing Middell's to put signage. Nobody knew the store was there. So the store is sitting back here, your street front's here. People are walking, nobody knew it was there. We got a variance for them. They put the sign out front. The Center City District started marketing Middell's in some of their quarterly newsletters, and their neighborhood newsletters, and their sales are fine. They renewed their lease. And they renewed their lease at a higher rent, and they're doing exceptionally well. Again, it's a good sign of retention because it would have been 21,000 square feet sitting on the second tier street in downtown. But we've seen it in the neighborhood. In DC, we had 14 corridors that were burned out in the riots in 1968. And that's why some of the, what I'm gonna talk about in the case studies is DC is one of the areas I'm gonna talk about. And it's because some of the neighborhoods are very similar to Cleveland, some of the dynamics. But we've had some retailers that have been there. Okay? Ben Chili Bowl. You may have heard of Ben's Chili Bowl. It is a, you know, cultural now institution in Washington, D.C. It was started by two brothers. The city work and the neighborhood work helped market them outside the neighborhood, particularly in the mid-90s when they weren't really doing very well. And that's why I say it's important to really look at retention as well as recruitment. And then some of the tools, you know, Keith talked about that heat slide or that heat map. One of the things we have found, and if any of you have savvy GIS team or you've got universities here, you get an intern to do this, you can actually map indicators, and this is
part of what we did in Philadelphia, oops, we flipped again. Can I? There we go. There we go, then we'll come back to the other one. We mapped every indicator for the city of Philadelphia in the downtown, because they really had no clue what the strength of the downtown market was and what the various neighborhoods or submarkets were in the downtown. So you can pull these kinds of indicators, you can put them into a GIS system, you simply, they're fairly simple to do. If you've got a neighborhood that there's something that you want to understand, whether it's occupancy, if it's residential, if it's income levels around that neighborhood, map it. And I am a big believer in mapping. Get an intern from one of the universities. They'd probably love to have it. It builds their portfolio. And now if you go to the one behind it, this is where I apologize because I was flipping slides in and out this morning. You know, Keith and Randy both talked about getting that information. This is really simple, and I apologize, you may not be able to read it here, but what we've done is we mapped the core. This is actually the core. This is the primary trade area. We did indicators for the city of Philadelphia and then the region, because again, we were having trouble selling downtown Philadelphia to some of the national tenants. And we have a Trader Joe's, and we have a Macy's. We didn't know until 2 years ago there wasn't a Marshall's. And again, you know, they have a very odd retail mix. Walnut Street is very high-end retail, and they have a ton of restaurants. So we did this because we wanted to demonstrate to them who the core market was, and it's just simple indicators. I mean, it's an Excel sheet that we made fancy. We put the logo up, and they have a great design team, so they make everything I do look pretty. I don't make anything look pretty, so that's, you know, the graphic team has been really good about this. But it's just simple numbers, and we bifurcated the census data to look at the income levels, so we could really spread that out, because we knew that's what the market was. So now we're gonna make it go two ahead. So this is just a synopsis of, I think, a typical toolkit, and Keith had talked about some of these kinds of tools. This is something to keep in mind. Start with some of the simple ones. I mean, it's easy enough just to pull data together. And so then I'm gonna walk through a couple cases. How am I doing on time? Okay. Well, I'm from D.C., I can talk for 3 hours, you know. I can just pretend I'm on the Senate floor and hold one of those coups where I just don't stop. You know, I can go for like 27 hours without stopping as long as I don't sit down. So I'm going to walk you through some case studies. And the first one is Philadelphia, and this is a... No, we messed up my slides again. Okay. Then, if you go back one more, before you begin on it. Nope, one with the great, there you go. This is a new project in Philadelphia, and this is on Market Street. And Philadelphia has a lot of parcels. They have a lot of vacant parcels. They have surface parking lots. Now you have to understand, I live in DC, we have no surface parking lots left. And if there's a surface parking lot, I guarantee you some guy from New York has come in and bought it. He's assembled it for some guy in the Middle East or somebody in Germany. There is nothing left that's available to develop anywhere at this point in Washington, DC. So the city had projects like this that were being looked at. They had a lot of surface lot. So they hired us, and I have to say, it was one of those odd moments in life. Now we go to the BN on it. We got the job 7 minutes after announcing our other company. And I am the rental company, and then I'm a partner in Community Retail Catalyst. I don't think anybody's ever won a job in 7 minutes. It was just one of those moments in life, and I decided it was meant to be. So they hired us to look at downtown Philadelphia. They knew they wanted to strengthen their retail database or market base, and they had absolutely no clue what to do. We did an analysis of what was in the city, we looked at the market, we looked at all the indicators, and one of the things we looked at was all the organizations in the city of Philadelphia that were selling Philadelphia. We had six really strong organizations. You had the city, we had the Industrial Development Corporation, we had two key business improvement districts, the Tourism Corporation, and all of them had a lot of data, but none of them had data relevant to retail. And when we did our report, I got a good ass kicking, I would say, and I got yelled at because I was criticizing probably the best website in Philadelphia. It was like a 4.5-page email on a Saturday night at midnight. You know, this was our first new report, and I was really stressed out writing this. And I wrote her back and said, you have a great website, it's not retail-centric. And the client's boss gave me a thumbs up and said, you handled it perfectly. So one of the things we realized was Philadelphia had a lot of data, but it wasn't concentric. So one of our recommendations was create a retail portal and build a brand. And we built the architecture for them, and they have a local advertising firm on hand, and that's on a retainer, and they built this campaign called Be In On It.
And as we move through, I'm going to walk you through some of the components of it. This is the website, and it's www.philadelphiaretail.com. We looked at everybody else's website to see what was there, what worked, what didn't, what were people including. And this website has a database of available property, it has news, it has demographics, it has information on the retailers that are there. But part of what we developed as well, we had a confidence level, it was Philadelphia in many people's minds. You know, kind of like DC is still the murder capital of the world in some people's minds. So we realized we had to take that and we had to counter that impression. So we reached out to five of the top retailers in the market. One of them is, and this is him, he's the merchandising director for Barney's National. His name is Simon Doolin. He was like, yeah, I'll do a testimonial for you. You can use me, baby, use me. He let us photograph him in one of his windows holding his mannequin. We got a testimonial from, and that's on the next slide, you'll see this, the woman who has the franchise for Nicole Miller. We got Macy's, we got Stephen Lagos, and we got Iron Chef Stephen Starr to do this. And we had a testimonial campaign that went along with this. So we started at, really, it was almost the million square foot, you know, height level. We said, we have to get it up here, we have to change the reputation of where Philadelphia is in the retail mind, and not just the retail mind of the nationals. We knew that Philadelphia was really healthy because of its mix of local and national tenants, restaurants and local tenants. And Philadelphia is a food town. They have far less national food retailers than they do local food retailers. You know, you've got a lot of ethnic neighborhood. They have Reading Terminal, which is like your West Side Market, but a little bit different. They have the Italian Market in South Philadelphia. So we harvested a lot of chefs, including a lot of chefs who didn't want to spend the money to be in New York City that ended up in Philadelphia. So these are the kinds of things that we push. We also did a lot of custom research. And we started with a retail report that we were able to use as a PDF that said basic demographic as well as market capacity. We showed them what the retail demand was in Center City. It started out as a 2-page report, it's gone up to 6 pages. And I will say, the bid there is the godfather of bids for the oldest business improvement district in the United States. So they have the capacity to do research. They do a state of city, Center City report every year. It's really become the benchmark for any other community. So they had access to data. It was just changing the mindset of creating a retail report. But then as we started reaching out to the retailers, and we had the data, we had the material, we had the information, what we realized is we still weren't getting the attention. So we started creating very custom reports. We did one on kids, and that's this. We did one for big box, and we did one for home furnishings. And it was just salient facts that would get the attention. And with the kids retail one, you know, one of the things we did, and it's, my client told me the other day I had bigger balls than anybody she'd ever met, and I was like, thank you. That was like the nicest thing she'd ever said to me. And my client is, she's a fashionista. I get yelled at if my eyebrows aren't straight. I would be yelled at for how I look today, I guarantee it. Your lipstick's not on. I'm like, you know what, I got your Bloomingdale's. Who cares, right? It doesn't matter what I look like. But she's very adamant about you have to look the part. And I will call children's retailers up, and I've gotten Carter's attention, which is one of the best kids retailers in America. I called him up and I said, I have a lot of sex in Philadelphia, why aren't you calling me back? And I kid you not, the guy called me back in 5 minutes, he's laughing. And he said, I don't know who you are, but what are you doing? And I told him, I'm a retail recruiter for downtown Philadelphia, I've got 24,000 babies that have been born, and we have no place to shop. He said, talk to me. And it's one of the things, so that's why we started creating very custom reports. We did one on Big Box after we signed Marshalls, and we suddenly are talking to Big Box. So it's taking, you know, if you've got some of these neighborhoods, and I know I'm going to screw the names of the neighborhoods up probably, but it was one of the ones over by, what's the one that we were near from Shaker Heights? Buckeye. Okay, you've got a neighborhood like that. There's some really cool properties over there. Take the facts that are in that neighborhood. You know, get some of the salient points, start selling them to target retailers that you want to bring in, including regional retailers. It's amazing when you start to pull those little pieces of factoids together and you bring them all together, it helps to build a story. And that's what, we're just going to walk through these fairly quickly. We are big into imagery. This is a development map, and we couldn't keep our hands on this. We would walk into a meeting, invariably it disappeared. So we now print them and we give them to the retailers. But what it allowed us to do, we'd sit in a meeting, for example, and we did. We talked to Bloomingdale's. They're looking. They haven't signed a deal, but it's been in the, you know, Women's Wear Daily and the New York Times, so I can say it. We walked them through what was going on.
and we update this map on a regular basis. We have it so it's segmented for residential development, the new units, the new hotels that are coming into the city, and we are able to show people the level of activity. You can do this on a neighborhood scale. We do it in DC on a neighborhood scale. We're just going to keep flipping through. Relevant indicators. And again, part of this was us trying to sell. Keith talked about traffic drivers. Philadelphia has, and I use a lot, I mix them back and forth. Philadelphia has a flat growth of employment. Some of it is their tax situation. Some of it is what's going on in the market around them. And we realize, and that, you know, that's one of the first things they'll look at. They're like, you're not growing a job. We're not coming there. You're not growing. So we started to put this kind of information on maps to show them where the clusters were. We were growing in other ways, but they really weren't growing jobs, and it really was a taxation issue. The city has now adjusted all the tax rates, and we're starting to see larger companies stay in the city and come back into the city from the suburbs, again, because of this whole urban interest. Pedestrian counts. This is something we track. We used to have interns, again, I love interns, and they stand out on the key corners and they use something called a clicker, and they would just count people walking by. And we started doing it, and we'll do it in DC. We've done it in a lot of cities, doing exactly the same thing. And I guarantee the brokers will do that, and I've seen developers. You know, they just kind of stand there, and they just stand there, and they watch. And they're counting bodies as they're coming by. Philadelphia has invested in very expensive software. I think they're like a test model, so they probably got it at a discount knowing them. But they actually now have cameras on the street. We update this data on a monthly basis. Transit use. We have two major transit hubs in downtown. We've got one that has 100,000 people coming in and out of it, you know, a week. And interestingly enough, it sits on top of a mall that is failing. And the mall is failing because of the merchandise mix in the mall, and the owner hasn't put any money into it. But by showing the retailers this and local retailers this, we've gotten the attention. We've opened like 11 small retailers. We started doing what Keith and Randy both talked about. You go to the other neighborhoods, and we're not poaching, we're inviting them to expand into the neighborhoods. This kind of data is great. It's showing, you know, for restaurants and coffee shops in the morning, showing PM traffic. For restaurants, it's great. And one of the other things, what we did, was we tracked restaurants and cafes, and we actually map it by seats, because again, livability, it's what's that vibrancy in downtown? And it was all done to change perception. So if you can do this and you can map it, you know, I'm not a map person. I have made maps, they're a little bit cursory, but again, it's something visual that a retailer can look at. And we did it for ICSC. I did it at 5:30 in the morning because the guy said, you either put it on a map or I'm canceling the meeting with you. So I sat and put it on a map. It was kind of crude, but it worked. They're now coming in for a site tour. And then we benchmark everything. And again, we benchmark it by that narrow core area. We benchmark it by the primary trade area, the city, and then the region. And we have found by benchmarking this, and I'll pick on Container Store again, they were very interested in downtown. You know, it would be like being across, well, maybe a little bit further than across Lake Erie, but it was like across the river in New Jersey, and then they're in King of Prussia, which is the very big, high-end, 1.8 million square foot luxury mall in the suburbs. And they said, we're going to go there, maybe we'll come in downtown. I don't think we can do all three. We were able to work with her and help her understand the difference in the region and the downtown. And they just opened in the King of Prussia Mall, and they're now looking at downtown because they think they can support it. And for us, it was, you know, for you in a neighborhood, can you take somebody who's across from the West End Market and grow them into your neighborhood? Can you benchmark that neighborhood that has the same level of traffic or foot traffic where you've got a grocer who's driving traffic when the market's not open? And you can do this on any scale, and it's really useful. You've got to make their lives easier. And the targeted indicators, this is one of the ones we use for kids. I mean, we really aren't having a lot of sex in Philadelphia, as we say. I mean, this is babies. We've had 24,000 babies born. There are strollers everywhere. And again, you cannot buy a crib. 24,000 kids, no crib. There are no toy stores in Center City, Philadelphia. So we work with Toys R Us, pop-up stores. We're getting Toys R Us to open pop-up stores. And then we created a kids retail-centric website. And it's more than just kids. It actually talks about education, it talks about housing and daycare. And this has been a great resource. I mean, you can build a portal off your website, you can build a page on your website. If it's restaurants you're looking for, if you have growth in your residential base, and you're trying to shape that neighborhood, you could put Residents R Us. You can have a simple little, page that comes off your own CDC, your own neighborhood group's website, whatever the information it is. But you gotta make it appealing, and you've gotta make it easy to find. And then we do deals, and we regularly send this out. When we get a cluster, you know, anything three and more is a trend. Anytime we start to see a couple of deals that have happened, we map it, we update this, and we send it out locally and nationally. We have one that's basically focused on local, and then we have the national one. And it's really helped us build market share. It's capturing people's attention, because they start to see things like an Ulta coming in, they'll see a Marshall's coming in. They see movement, and where you see this thing, Nitwit, that's Chestnut Street. That is, you know, Walnut Street commands 110, 150 a foot. It is where the very high-end retail is. It's where everybody wants to be. And, you know, you guys are getting $15 a foot, to kind of put it in perspective. Our side streets get 15 to 20 a foot. Chestnut Street is the old transit way. It's kind of dark. It's part of it's the building construction and the sun angles. We're now starting to see the retailers who want to be there are moving onto Chestnut Street. So that's also why we show this. And then this just gives you an idea of our target. But we have a couple things that I'm going to another area to look at in Philadelphia is if you Google or go onto the website, it's called Midtown Village. It is three blocks. It's the block east of Broad. And Philadelphia is a grid city. So you've got Broad Street and you've got Chestnut Street. It's the key east-west street. This is just east of Broad Street. It's an area that, yeah, it's a little dicey, and it was a little dicey. A guy named Tony Goldman from New York came in, just like what he did in New York and what he did in Miami Beach. He assembled three blocks. He controls it, he markets it, he manages it like a mall. He will not rent to a national tenant. He has a waiting list of local tenants who are going in there. He gives them working capital loans. He has merchandise. He's got a soap guy, a chocolate guy. He's got little foodies. He's got a couple of the local chefs he's capitalized to put in there. And he has built this neighborhood called Midtown Village that is the hottest market in downtown Philadelphia at this point. It is where everybody goes when they want to go out and hang out. And so it's worth looking at to see how they sell it and what they have on their sites. So the Great Streets program is a Main Street program. We lost our Main Street program due to bad management. The city came back and they put it back together. They call it the Great Streets program. And they're able to layer exactly what you're talking about with the Neighborhood Retail Assistance Program, all the tools. So we are putting retail back into these corridors that have not seen retail since 1968. And it's really kind of amazing to see what's happening. And then I am going to make it go to one more slide. Go four slides up. Focus on design. So I'm going to argue with Keith a little bit. You can do anything, okay? This is Walmart. Walmart's opening six stores in Washington, D.C. This is not your mother's Walmart. And this one, and actually if you go to the next slide, these two Walmarts are the ground floor of major redevelopment projects that are now sitting on top of it. The city worked very well with Walmart, and it was the neighborhood that demanded it. They didn't want that big, ugly box in their neighborhood, so they wanted residential. One of the Walmarts is literally, there's a corner, you enter Walmart, it is wrapped by neighborhood retail. Walmart is funding a retail training program in the city of D.C., working with locals so they can get hired as well as open stores, and then you've got residential above it. So I'm a big believer, if they really want to be there, they will, they'll find a way. And if you really want them, your neighborhood, there's a little bit of friction, there are ways to work and design to make these projects work. So I had to do the Walmart one. We've seen it for dollar stores, and we've seen it for the grocery stores and the drugstores. We have drugstores, that's one of the things that's coming in, and banks. We have a Walgreens, for example, that took over a Chinese restaurant. They renovated it back to the original Art Deco. Nobody wanted Walgreens. So they've done that. They've worked with the neighborhood, and I have images, and I can put these into this slideshow for you when I send it to my final. We've also seen it with not a dollar store, but a store similar to that, where they worked with them and they actually reconfigured the store into like an old traditional downtown. If you go to slide 50, I mean, this is a good example. This is an old bank building in New York City. That's a Trader Joe's. And every woman in this room has probably read the book or watched the stupid movie, He's Just Not That Into You. Okay? If the retailers don't want to be there, they're not going to come. But if they really want to be there, they will find a way to make it work. And if you go to the next slide, again, it's a little bit different economics. This is CB2. They want it to be in Washington, D.C. They need 36,000 square feet. Whoops, keep going. One more. There, okay? That's three owners. okay? These buildings were vacant. One of them had a sneaker store. That's three owners who worked together. They put a master lease together. They took out and they created an entranceway in the dividing walls. The lease term says when CB2 leaves, they have to put those dividing retainer walls back. They didn't take anything out structurally, but they now have this really cool space with three landlords willing to work together. And this is, I mean, DC is landlocked, and that's one of the things we have. We have a lot of creativity there, and we're able to put a little pressure on a Walgreens or like a dollar store, which they are doing in the neighborhood. There's a dollar store going in right next to one of the Walmarts, and part of it is because it's a very different price point, and they're not competitors. And it's by putting that pressure on, but again, it's the demand that we have, and we have no land. So that's one of the other issues. We have that benefit. We have no land. So that is what you work with.
What do you find to be, seeing the space that we have, our greatest asset right now, our greatest strength?
I think your greatest asset, frankly, is your building structures. You've got incredible building stock. It's really suitable for retail. You've got a scale in the neighborhoods where you've got buildings that are juxtaposed to each other that almost come back to the old Main Street style. And it really is the kind of environment that creates a nice, intimate environment for retail. And the buildings are beautiful.
What do you find to be our weakness that we still need to definitely work on?
Probably lack of pedestrian traffic. That's one of the things that when we were touring the city, I said there's nobody out walking in most of the neighborhoods. And even in some of the residential areas, except for the area, Ohio City, where we saw a lot of people on the street. When we were in Buckeye, there was very few people on the street. There was very little traffic on the street. And like that neighborhood, as well as a couple other, it was the quality of the storefronts that were vacant or in disrepair. So if you could clean that up, which I think that was the message that was heard over and over again. Your streets themselves are spectacularly clean for an urban market, which really surprised me. But if you could get even simple paint up, fix up, and clean that so it physically looks a little bit better, I think it would be more inviting when you're doing tours.
Now, you had talked earlier about the whole Starbucks going to Cambridge and different things like that. What do you think is the biggest mistake retailers make when moving into a community?
Not understanding the community they're in and not understanding whether or not the community wants them and forcing themselves, or if they haven't done their research, which I think they've gotten, particularly national retailers, do a much better job. They really understand their markets at this point because they can't afford to make a mistake. 15 years ago, a retailer says, I have to open 100 stores. I assume 5 of them or 10 of them aren't going to work. Now they cannot afford to make that mistake, particularly if you're a public company. You just simply cannot afford to have one. So they're much more, you know, they do much better due diligence on the market. Where the problem is on the local retailer. For example, you may have somebody opening a restaurant and bar in a neighborhood that has a cap on hours of, you know, drinking hours or license hours. That's one of the things that happened in Miami, and all of the restaurants that opened failed because the nightlife is 12 to 5. The nightlife was not 7 to midnight, and they had to close. So it's understanding what the bylaws and the policies are and the rules are, and then who's your customer? Are they there?
You also spoke about selling the vision. What do you think is the most difficult part of someone trying to sell a vision into getting that retail space and getting into the community?
Really getting the story down and understanding what are the assets that you need to sell. And if you have multiple parties doing it, making certain that everybody's on the same page. And being able to articulate it in front of the retailer's eyes, you know, not to the residential. You need to sell it to the person who's got that business. And that's a slightly different angle than you would if you're selling it to a potential resident or if you're, you know, selling it to an elected official.
And you had talked about right now current trends, millennials really kind of driving the marketplace. What do you think is the next trend? Like forecasting ahead, what do you think you're starting to see?
Babies are growing up. I'm not sure I'm prepared to answer that, in all honesty. I know in retail, you're going to start to see smaller stores. And that is probably a trend that you're going to start seeing rolling out over the next 5 years. When the Targets of the world, the Best Buys, who now have Best Buy Mobile, they have recognized they still have an audience. They can't support a 40,000 square foot store. Okay, we'll go in and do 1,200 square feet. It's a showroom and we'll ship it to them. So I think you're going to see a lot more of that.
Tim, tell us, what are you most excited about right now in developing in Cleveland?
I'm excited about the optimism of our future and where we're headed. I mean, we know where we've been. We know where we are, and when you look back from where we've come from, we've come a long way, And so we're just excited about where we're going.
And speaking of where you're going, what is the current project that you're working on that you're really excited about?
Well, there are many projects that we're working on, but the project that gets the most buzz from us, the project that we directly developed, is the Bridgeport Cafe and Cornucopia Place. So we're really excited about that because that's an example of thinking totally outside of the box, thinking about what the needs of the community are, understanding the market and understanding the market dynamics that we can't get everything that we want, but how do we do something that both enhance the environment, provides a really good asset to the community and a good functionality of space, while at the same time making sure that, you know, you can pay the bills every month.
Yeah, definitely. We love Bridgeport over at TV20. We've obviously done some shows with you guys, and as well as at the Go Red campaign at City Hall you provided. Aside from Bridgeport Cafe, what do you think is the next step for you and your company as far as branching off of that, expanding that development, and making the next thing in Cleveland?
Okay, so one of the reasons why Bridgeport Cafe and Cornucopia Place are so successful is because it aligns with everything else that we're doing around it. And so, I mean, we could tell the story of how, you know, basically it connects with the hydroponic greenhouse, it connects with the urban agriculture innovation zone, it connects with the whole theme of health and wellness. So it really connects and aligns with everything else that's going on. So we're building the momentum, and that's why we're so excited about the future, because the momentum is so big and so strong that we're anxious to get back engaged with the community to plan out the next 5 years. This plan, when you think about it, 2006, when we engaged the community to come up with the vision for Lower Kinsman, there hadn't been anything developed in Lower Kinsman in over 40 years, anything. And so when you think about all of the things that we've done between East 55th and East 93rd, it's all been done in the last 6.5 years. So we're excited about all of the possibilities of going forward. We have ideas ourselves. We want to share them with the community. We believe that we can make them happen, and they're not, you know, the typical. They're like, you know, Cornucopia Place, something unique, something edgy, something exciting, something vibrant that will attract the secondary market as well. And that's what's important for successful retail and for successful commercial development.
And you touch upon three very important things going on in Cleveland: expansions, urban farming, restaurants and food, and then of course medical. And was that in the plan, or did that all kind of help happen without even trying?
That was, again, we sort of grew from the foundation of the planning. And we attempted to do some things that were proposed in the neighborhood strategy, that once we did the feasibility of those things, we recognized we couldn't do them. One in particular was the tree farm. We found that doing a tree farm, converting the Forgotten Triangle into a tree farm, was not feasible. The amount of money that it would take and then the return on that investment was just not a wise investment. So we thought very hard about, well, how can we still deliver, or at least something close to what was in the neighborhood strategy? And we just decided that, well, you know, let's just not try to be the people that know urban agriculture, because we're not urban agriculture entrepreneurs, or we're not horticulturalists. So why not just create this concept of a urban agriculture innovation zone and allow those who have an interest to do urban agriculture to come to us, propose their ideas, their plans, and we would back the plans that have the highest and best use for our residents and for the neighborhood economy. And that's how we sort of grew that concept. And now today, you know, you don't hear the Forgotten Triangle. The Forgotten Triangle is now the Urban Agriculture Innovation Zone.
What do you think is the biggest challenge in developing in neighborhoods?
Well, the biggest challenge is you want to do things that are beneficial to the community, but everything has a bottom line. And so not all things that you can think of that you say, well, this would be great for the community, really works with the market dynamics. So you want to find that marriage that works. You want to find that place where you can meet your bottom line and do something purposeful that really serves the community. That's the sort of balance that we fight to maintain.
But you're winning that battle right now at the Triangle.
Well, I would say, well, yeah, we're winning that battle there. I wouldn't say that we're winning that battle throughout the community. We are excited because we found the place and we have examples of how we can win the battle. So we're anxious and excited about creating other spaces like that. Things that are new, things that are dynamic, things that we're getting calls from all over the country. We'd like to see your community kitchen. That's an interesting concept. How does that work? You have a health conscious restaurant. You can actually make money. You could actually do that. You know, people will actually come to a restaurant with a healthy theme because that's generally perceived as nasty food or food that doesn't taste well. So we've been able to show and demonstrate that, yes, you can. And you can create retail space that's, again, purposeful, but meets its bottom line. And so we're full of ideas, other ideas, to do not similar things, but from a balancing of market dynamics and providing ideal services standpoint, you know, that would do that. And we're confident that when we re-engage the neighborhood to plan out the next 5 to 10 years, that we'll come up with some really exciting things that we'll be able to develop.
Yeah, that once actually was the parking for Boeing. So they were stuck with about 11,000 square feet and just a side drive lane, and that was it. And so we basically sliced the building virtually in half. You can see it was a clear span building, great structural steel. The rear wall, the side walls were all in fantastic shape.
This is the retail center, the old retail center, which is the old Giant Eagle here, that moved out and moved up to West 117th. This whole plaza was torn down, and it's now wrapped over. The residents in the neighborhood are passionate about this project and this property. Because of the old Church of First Christ Scientists, there have been master planning sessions done about what this property needs to be.
And again, we always put back to that mantra, why are we doing this? Well, you invest in your buildings, if you think about it, on a bricks and mortar basis. There's no building that can make money unless it invests in things like tenant improvements. So you've got to do those types of things. What we're asking you to do is to deal with the external issues that impact the value of the property through the Clean and Save program. So we, in essence, got them to consider it. We worked with the City of Cleveland to get the final approvals at the end of 2005, and we began to deliver services in 2006. And I think we made a couple other very good decisions during that period. One was, in structuring our program, we decided that, in addition to the ambassadors, we decided that we want an extra layer above the ambassadors, or complementing the ambassadors, excuse me, it's a bad term, where we employ off-duty Blues, who in essence are part of our system and respond to us, but allowed us to have direct communication with the Cleveland Police Department. That, I think, was a key decision, because unlike a lot of other municipalities which have business improvement districts, and Catherine, I know you're familiar with many of them, as some of you in the room are, that was an unusual step. Most business improvement districts did not take that step. But we felt it did a couple things. One, it allowed us to have first respondents respond very, very quickly to the situations where there's a need. And secondly, that off-duty Blue, if you will, is in direct contact with the third district. When you think about that relationship, all of us in the room know that police respond very well to the police. So we thought the system that we created would work very nicely. And the reality is, when we created the system, not only did that relationship work well, additional things happened in downtown, like the Euclid Corridor project, which brought additional leasing capacity to downtown in a way that, in fact, it historically did not exist. The Cleveland Metropolitan School District, because of the transportation link at Tower City, began to invest in additional officers in downtown Cleveland. The Sheriff's Department, over a period of time, increased their visibility and capacity in downtown. So what we began to develop was a very interactive system. And again, day to day, the relationship with the police has been outstanding. We really do a lot of work with them. We strategize with them, we meet with them on a daily basis, sometimes, depending on the situation. And it's really put us in a position where we created, to be frank, that platform for investment. And to be frank, I don't think you'd see the level of investment that's occurring at downtown Cleveland right now without that five-year experience of us moving the needle on downtown's cleanliness and downtown's safety. Now again, the reality is the statistics are very, very good. I'm not gonna stand up here and say we take credit for those statistics. But we know that those ambassadors who are walking concierge, who are the ICS for the Cleveland police, who are working to keep our sidewalks and our gutters and our right-of-ways free of graffiti, they are all vitally important and again create that platform so additional investors would be comfortable. And remember the mantra. The mantra was increase the value of the real estate. So when we back to the property owners after 5 years, to be frank, the vast majority of them said again, yes. You see the investment that we paid in those services. We've seen the platform that's been created. We see the needle being moved in terms of the perception of safety and the perception of cleanliness. So from our perspective, that's been a great opportunity. I know in the marketplace, we now have additional business improvement districts in Cleveland. Obviously, Ohio City, the Gordon Square area, and we've been lucky enough, to be frank, to respond to RFPs in both of those instances, and we've been chosen to provide those services as part of their network. So the partnership we've created, I think, is added to the whole, because now we have neighborhoods that are, in essence, following the same model, and again, beginning to bridge those perceptual issues that we're talking about.
We own and manage almost 1 million square feet of residential and commercial space in the city. From Detroit Shoreway, our friend Peter is here from Detroit Shoreway, the development organization where we manage their portfolio of residential and commercial space, to Schaefer Square, which we've now owned for 9 years. So we've been forced to learn a lot about what our best practices in maintenance, safety, and crime prevention. And just want to share a few thoughts because we really can't cover that topic in a half an hour and want to have some time for interaction with you. One moment of shameless self-promotion. Within our management company, which is a team of 45 people, we have two divisions. We have our private sector division, which we manage our own assets, and we manage for other private sector investors. And we have a civic management division, which is structured a little bit differently, where we manage assets for public and semi-public owners and institutions. And the big difference is that there are different expectations in both places, and there's a different cost structure. It's actually cheaper to hire us if you're a civic owner, because the margins in those deals are less. And I'm very happy to say, very proud to say, actually, that we were just hired to manage St. Luke's Phase 3, which is the office of the 80,000 square foot office building on Schaefer Boulevard, right down the street from our office in Schaefer Square, and part of our civic division. So that may be of interest to some of you who are work for community development organizations or our community or other kind of community organizations. There's really very little separation between best practices in maintenance and best practices in safety and crime prevention, because they work together. And if there is, particularly on the question of how do you address issues of maintenance in urban retail, if there is a single thing you remember from what I said, as unlikely as that might be, remember one thing I said, it's this. Establish expectations with your tenants, and particularly with your vendors. One of the things we do at all of our properties is we have an annual meeting with all of the vendors who provide any kind of maintenance service. And if they don't attend, they don't get renewed. Trash haulers, landscapers, snow plowing, and every other vendor we might have from property to property. And they differ. Arbor Park is not the same as Brooklyn Center, it's not the same as Schaefer Square. But we have a meeting with them every year, usually at the property, and we'll walk the property. Let them know what our expectations are. And we have, since we started doing that about 5 years ago, we've never had any of them say, oh, I can't look for that expectation, or that's not reasonable. It not only establishes what performance standards you have in them, it builds teams. And every property is a team. So to us, that is the most important thing. Know what you want, and then establish those expectations and set them at the highest end of what you believe is reasonable to expect and what you're paying for.
All right, Mark, tell us about what inspired the development of the area with Foreman Mills and Save a Lot and everything going on over in Garrett Square.
Well, I was originally approached to look at the vacant top supermarket building by Tracy Nichols, the Director of Economic Development, and she asked whether I would have any ideas to redevelop it. She did say that she had a grocery store interested, and that was a great start. So once that was laid the ground, that once she laid the groundwork, then I was able to go out and find another tenant to occupy the building alongside them and really bring much needed services to the neighborhood, as well as over 150 jobs to the neighborhood. And in planning the shopping center, what I realized was that when this building was constructed originally during the White administration, 65,000 square foot grocery stores were in vogue. They were huge. Today, that's far too big. But with a 65,000 square foot building came a huge parking lot. That parking lot was underutilized. So I thought there was an opportunity not only to fill the building with two users, but then to make use of this ample parking we had for other retail buildings. And so to this day, we actually were able to add another needed use for the Garrett Square neighborhood, which is Advance Auto Parts. So we now have an auto parts retailer there, along with an ATM, so we have a banking presence as well. So four uses on what was at one time only one use, one site.
That's amazing and so inspiring. What is next for that square? What's next for the area and development?
Well, interesting question, because once we got national press for the redevelopment, and we were in several of the national publications such as Chain Store Age and others, my phone started to ring, and I was being approached by smaller retailers, wireless companies, Radio Shack, national restaurant stores. And so at this point, we don't have any small shop space available on the property. So we're working very closely with the administration and with the councilman, Kevin Conwell, to actually build off of what we created, which is really this, the impetus for the redevelopment of the area. And so I think in the future, everybody's going to see a few small shop buildings with additional, what I like to call necessity retail uses, that are currently missing in the area.
Tracy, congratulations on a very successful event today, first of all. What would you give as the first piece of advice as someone trying to open up and develop a retail space here in Cleveland?
Well, I think we heard a lot about clean and safe, and I think that when you're working in a neighborhood where there's a lot of vacancies, we really have to get people comfortable that this is a place that they can come and visit. They want to do their shopping there. So I think it's really critical to find ways to clean up the storefront area and really give a perception of safety, whether that means having residents that are walking around, making it look as if, okay, this is a very lively area, or whether it means maybe you're adding some cameras or perhaps just more lighting would do it.
Now, I was doing my homework, and you were talking about inventory. Aside from cleanliness, what do you think is missing most in our communities right now?
Well, I think that what we really need to do, we need the data. This is the problem that I see in most of our communities. I came in before today, I did a little check of all the websites of our community development corporations, and I didn't see a lot of information about the demographics for their area, about the square footage that might be available, about the types of retail they already have in their neighborhoods. We've got to be well prepared. We have to be more professional about our retail so that we can get more people interested in doing retail in the city of Cleveland.
That's great. Now, what else is on the horizon for our economic development group?
Well, I think we're working on a lot of fun stuff right now. Downtown is hopping. We have an incredible trend of people moving into downtown. We have more residents moving into downtown. And where those types of residential properties are conversions from Class B and C office to mixed use, then economic development's been very involved. My entire team out there, they're working on a lot of different efforts, including microlending with ECDI as our partner, the Health Tech Corridor, which has been hugely successful. It's now the most successful BRT project, that's bus rapid transit project, in the nation. And so we've just got so many things clicking, we just got to keep the momentum going.